you. It doesn't matter whether we are black or white, Latino, straight or gay, Asian American or Native American. We are one people, we are one family, we are one house. Go with love. Get out there and vote like we never voted before. Go with love.
In November 2016, 100 million people chose to sit at home. They didn't vote, but it's 2020 now, we've seen it all. So don't wait to make a call on where your future's gonna go. The polling places are open, you don't have to wait anymore. Today's your day, cause tens of millions in the nation are voting earlier than they ever have before. Vote with us, get together, get in early. Vote with us, plan ahead and spread the word. We are the generation of persistence. Wear a mask and social distance. Join the movement, don't you miss this. Viva la resistance. You got this.
You have enough in the movement to keep it really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Absolutely. I mean, we have years and years more than these people are going to live. So we have a lot of time on our hands.
I'm in no way, like, hiding under a rock or going dormant. I'm not going to be quiet. I'm majoring in activism. In school. That's my thing. I'm just doing things on my own terms.
Wow. So amazing. So what does it mean, going in by your own terms? I mean, what does that mean to you?
Yeah, I feel like, doing something on one's own terms really, like, at least for me, means like being honest about the stuff that you are doing, what you want to get done, and being realistic about the fact that some things aren't going to be able to get done, but you can still kind of push for them. And when enough people are doing something with their own, way of doing things, and everybody comes together in this incredible harmony of like eclectic ideologies and stuff, somehow, some way, some spark ignites, and then bam, you got a movement, you got a protest, you got a piece of legislation going through, and it moves really fast sometimes, and that's really cool.
You were talking in the clip about this is a lifetime, this is my lifetime, and having that view of it, that it's actually it's this longer process, and that we can take our time. We don't have to burn ourselves out. We don't have to actually sacrifice ourselves, because it's not one or two. It's not just Emma Gonzalez anymore. Under Emma Gonzalez are thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of other young people who are finding their voices.
Yeah, exactly. There are so many people out there. As I had said before, Rule 34, if you think that there are other people out there, there probably are. I mean, if there's billions of people on this planet, chances are there's at least one other person right now in this world who's doing the exact same thing that you're doing. And that's a really comforting feeling, honestly.
Wow. What do you think about voting, Emma, and people, young people right now who are, some of them are like, I don't believe in this system. I want to accelerate its collapse. I don't buy into these candidates. What do you say to that?
I mean, personally, voting is one of the easiest and quickest ways to get a very concise and pointed piece of information out to a specific spot. Votes actually do change a lot of things, and it actually really does positively impact a lot of people, especially people who can't vote. There's a ton of people who can't vote, and do you know why? Because the system is bad. And so if you want to make sure that their voices get heard and you don't really care about your voice so much because you think it's going to get squished or whatever, you know, ask them, how do you want me to vote? I'll be your voter.
That's interesting. So instead of voting for your own needs or
yeah.
priorities, you're also voting for other people.
You really are. I mean, there's so many people who are like, well, I don't want to vote. And it's like, who said it was all about you, bitch? Like, come on. You gotta think about everybody else who's impacted by the whole existence of the country. How do you feel in terms of being clearly, not to be mean, clearly older than I am? Yeah. How do you feel about your position, you know, like being of a different generation than us?
Well, I mean, when I look at the younger generation, I relate to you because we're all activists, you know, and it's when I was your age, I was just smoking weed and surfing and skating and like.
And that's not different from what a lot of us are doing, anyways.
Yeah, you know, we're part of this legacy. We're part of a movement that's been happening for 100 years already, and it longer than that. A social justice and a consciousness movement for humanity. And so I see you guys and I'm like, hell yeah. There's so many more people, you know, we can get that kind of mass that you were talking about earlier, that makes things change, that makes things happen. And so I enjoy like these moments where we get to intersect because I want you to know that, like, I'm here for you guys. I also know that it's good to step back, to let other people like you find your voice and your power in this movement, and to do what we're doing right now, take whatever shine that I have on me and put Emma Gonzalez in it, because the world needs to hear from you guys now. And so I see there's this great symbiotic relationship between these generations and this movement that's, you know, long lasting and has been happening forever.
Hello and welcome to our Vote With Us rally. I am Karan Menon, as you can maybe see by a title under my face, maybe not. I'm a college student. I'm a young spry man. And something that really appeals to me about this whole thing is that this is about getting young people to mobilize. I'm a young person and I'm voting for the first time in this election. So that's very, you know, very exciting. And what we just saw, first of all, can we react to that? I don't know if you guys are reacting in your rooms, but I'm here reacting to this. And I really enjoyed that. I think what Emma Gonzalez is doing and what Mark Ruffalo and she were talking about, just mobilizing young people to make a change, I think voting is super important in the idea that it's action, taking action on all the issues that we've been talking about over these last 4 years. And so it's super inspiring to see people my age going out there and making an actual difference. And so, you know, I invite you to, you know, channel that same energy, get hyped about voting, get hyped about making a change. And we're going to throw now to our next segment about a land acknowledgement before we get into all this. And then we'll talk more about the clips to come. So let's get into that. Ooh.
March, march to my own drum. March, march to my own drum. Hey, hey, I'm an army of one. Oh, I'm an army of one. March, march to my own drum. March, march to my own drum. Hey, hey, I'm an army of one. Oh, I'm an army of one. Brenda's back in heat cause she don't like Mondays. Underpaid days, triple E's in the hallways. Rent yourself a weapon and take it to the gun range. I'll cut the ash, you ain't going to the gun range. Standing with Emma and our sons and daughters. Watching our youth have to solve our problems. I follow them, so who's coming with me? You love me, half already hate me.
March, march to my own drum. March, march to my own drum.
Hey, hey, I'm an army of one. Oh, I'm an army of one.
March, march to my own.
march to my own drum. Hey, hey, I'm an army of one. Cities are sinking, ah, cause you know your city is sinking. Lies on truth and truth is fiction. Everybody's talking, who's gonna listen? What the hell happening, I'm sinking. March, march to my own drum. March, march to my own drum. Hey, hey, I'm an army of one. March, march to my own drum. Hey, hey, I'm an army of one. Oh, I'm an army of
The Chicks, that was amazing. Thank you. Now, there's so many ways to get out the vote. There's so many events going on to get out the vote, some in your area that you can attend between now and the election. And before we go on, we did say we're going to do a land acknowledgement. We're experiencing some difficulties there, but we're just going to do an acknowledgement. Right now, I am in Los Angeles, outside of USC, actually, where I go to school, although, you know, things are going crazy right now with that. But we just want to acknowledge the land that we're on right now. I am on Tongva, Tatavian and Chumash lands in LA here. And we'll see, you know, where we go with, if we get that video up. It's very important to acknowledge where we are and where we've come from. And a little more about just where we are at the moment, this event itself. You know, Vote With Us is all about activating our communities to get out, vote early, in person, by mail, and voting together. I talked about how I am a young person. Young people make up about 40% of eligible voters. And if just half of us turned up to the polls, we could change the entire trajectory of our democracy, putting us on a more progressive path for years to come. And we're coming together to witness the power of collective change right now. This is what this is all about. So you're going to hear a lot more amazing stories from activists around the country. And, you know, for these brilliant young change makers, activism is a way of life, as we saw with Emma Gonzalez, and we're going to see moving forward. And yeah, and going, and we're going to be, you know, obviously moving to different parts of the country. We're going to be going live Brooklyn, Detroit, Los Angeles, Miami, Philadelphia. You know, and going back to what we're talking about, you know, with the land that we're on right now. Today, Indigenous peoples continue to protect and remain in relationship with these, you know, with the land they're on, and will do so for the end of time. And it's vital to honor these beginnings and recognize the ongoing dedication and importance that Indigenous cultures having within our communities and within the land that we are gathering on, living, learning, and, you know, obviously right now making a change on. It's important to understand the longstanding history that's brought you to reside on this land and to seek to understand your place within that history. And as obviously, as we make changes moving forward, we have to keep the past in mind. So land acknowledgements don't exist in a past tense or a historical context. Colonialism is a current ongoing process, and we need to build our mindfulness of our present participation. And with that all in mind, and with this Vote With Us spirit all in mind, we're now going to throw to Orlando, where we have a exciting live rally going on, and we're super pumped for you to tune in and see what that's all about.
Peace, peace, 1, 2. No justice or justification. We trust in God, but can't trust in the nation. The cusp of generations searching for ventilation. If 2020 vision is any indication of where we are, where we've been, where do we go? American ain't legible. My rights are being left behind. In question times, they say invest in nines. I'm trying to rest my mind. The press be pressed to find stories about my kind, a suggested crime. Though many, many holler about justice reform, but won't put dollars where the hustler's born. You know our politicians, they love to perform, acting and singing that government song on how they love America. Well, you loving it wrong. We the people are becoming reborn. Yeah.
Cool, thanks. Lucina, can I hear you?
Yes. Hey, Phil.
Hey.
Of people just like you all around the world. I still believe that there's a place in this world for people, for a place for me and you. Up in the world. I still believe that there's a place in this world for people just.
Cool. Yeah. So we did have a technical difficulty that we cut to a sound check from Common. You're getting a little sneak preview already. Obviously, Common is not a rally in Orlando. So, you know, difference there. But we're going to be getting back to that. You're going to be getting a good look into, you know, what's coming up. And moving forward, we just want to talk about, you know, some of the things that are going on in Orlando. We're excited to go live moving forward, you know, with Desmond Mead, the founder of the Florida Rights Restoration Coalition. So that's something that you're going to be seeing coming up. And just a little intro of what that is. In 2018, there was a referendum on the ballot in Florida to restore the voting rights to returning citizens who are like formerly convicted people who have paid their debt to society. And this was a years-long crusade to restore voting rights for these people who had committed felonies. And the man leading this fight was a law school graduate named Desmond Mead, who was fighting for not only 1.5 million citizens, but he was doing this as an ex-felon. And so he was fighting for himself. And so this is someone who we're going to be having in conversation very soon. The people of Florida have voted, and the referendum had passed. But not long after that, the legislature passed, a modern-day poll to disenfranchise citizens. So we're going to talk about that moving forward. And I guess next we're going to be the next spot on our map, it looks like, is Brooklyn in New York City. You don't have to be an experienced activist to get involved, but we're turning this moment into a movement that kind of transcends where you are in the country. So next, we're going to be going live to Brooklyn, New York, with Plus One Vote, an organization dedicated to getting out the vote and creating a democracy that's more representative of its people. So whenever we can, let's go over and see what's going on there.
In New York, it is the first day of early voting in New York, and it is National Early Vote Day. My name is Saad Amer. I am the founder of Plus One Vote. And here we are here to mobilize and organize and get out the vote. So much is at stake at the ballot this year. Climate justice, social justice, voting rights, health care, gun violence. And we are here to make sure we all bring one plus one out there to the polls and march from right here straight to the ballot box. Are you guys ready?
Yeah! My name is Brianna Sia, and I'm the CEO and founder of Generation Vote, a youth-led organization dedicated to advancing youth voting rights in New York and beyond. And I am voting today in New York's first early voting in a major presidential election to honor those who have come before us, to honor those who have sacrificed so much for us to have the right to vote and to have early voting in New York. So get out and vote early. Thank you.
I'm Stuart Hendricks. I am from Freedom March New York City, youth-led civil rights organization fighting for young people in New York. We are here because there is so much on the ballot that we need people to show up for. We need to get cops out of our schools. We need to get our schools properly funded. We need to get a youth public advocate to advocate for people like Ellie. And more than anything else, I'm excited because we are seeing young people vote in numbers that are unprecedented. And we want to see all the young people who have driven this summer's movement follow through at the end of this election so that all of our electeds know that we will hold them accountable.
Hi, my name is Ellie Barron, and I'm the lead organizer of Action Core NYC. And I'm here today because I can't vote. I'm 17, but I'm here to encourage everyone to vote because we have a climate crisis going on right now. We have a climate emergency, and it's crucial that people exercise their right to vote and go to the ballot box today and vote for climate justice.
Hi, I'm Jamela Rose, the Deputy Public Advocate for Civics at the Office of the New York City Public Advocate, and I'm here today to vote early on October 24th because Black women's health is on the ballot. In New York City, Black women are 12 times more likely to die in childbirth than women, than their white counterparts all across the country. And all across the country, we're seeing Black maternal health not being prioritized, and that is something that I feel that when I vote today, I will be prioritizing. So I encourage everyone to vote today, and vote early.
Hi, my name is Jerome Fox II. I'm the executive director of 1 Million of Us, and I'm here for first-time voters, my first time voting in any primary election. And I'm here because for so long, young people have not had the voice to vote. For so long, young people have been underestimated. And for so long, young people have not had the opportunity to make changes in the democracy. So I'm out here with all these young people because we are ready to make changes. We're ready to make action, and we're here to vote. That's why we're out here, and that's why we're going to march to the polls, and we're going to march for our future. That's why we're here.
First of all, I would say anyone from my community, from the hood, from Brooklyn, from any projects, any hood in New York City that doesn't believe that they should vote, I would say I understand. And I would also say that that feeling of not feeling like your vote matters, that's on purpose. That you didn't just get there by accident. That was people are banking on the fact that you don't believe your vote matters. Right. So I would say that I understand there's a system that is in place to make us feel that we don't matter, you know, and I fell victim to that, too. So I'm not going to call you. I'm not going to get mad. I'm not going to call you out. What I will say is I understand. However, I will say that you've been misinformed just as I was. I didn't believe that my boy, The Wire, Boardwalk Empire, I was on television. And when it came down to, you know, my using my voice and my platform, I didn't think that I mattered. So how can I, you know, and I, from the outside looking in, I'm successful, right? And I still didn't think that I mattered. So how can I look at someone who's on my block, who came from my block, who's on the block right now? How can I turn to them and say, vote? They don't understand. I didn't understand. But what I will say is you were misinformed, brothers and sisters. You've been hoodwinked. You've been okie-doked. It's not true. If our vote didn't matter, they wouldn't be trying to steal it from us. And what I would say is don't think that the momentum stops after November 3rd. That's when the party begins. Because for everyone in New York City, we got a mayoral race coming up in June of 2021. And guess what? We got 3 people of color running for that office, 2 Black men and a sister. What I would tell you is get involved, educate yourself, find out who's running office, who's running for the next public advocate. And get to know people in our community that believe in us. So to anyone from my community who doesn't believe that their vote counts, again, I will say, I understand. I don't blame you for feeling that way. I felt that way. What I will tell you is, don't fall for the okey-doke. It was designed for us to feel that way. Get out and find out who is in our community. who are our council members, our council board members, and things of that nature, the district leaders. Find out who they are, because that's where our voice is most impactful, when we get to know those people or boots on the ground and then hold them accountable. That's how we start to build our confidence and our voice.
This is today, more than 5 centuries after Columbus, more than 2 centuries after this country was founded, and over a century after the emancipation. There's still blood in the streets, hate in hearts, voices being silenced, bodies being trafficked. And the forces that have plagued this country since its birth are still working to tear it apart. People are waiting for someone, anyone, to stop them. Now let's take a trip, but not of the physical. Let's move in time to today, 160 years ago today. There was blood in the streets, hate in hearts, and the same forces that plagued this country since its birth were working to carve up this land and tear it apart. People were waiting for someone, anyone, to stop them. It was at this time that everyday people like you and me dared to face down the forces of their time. They called themselves the Wide Awakes. They wore capes and wielded an extraordinary superpower. They believed that they could stand up for revolutionary ideas, bring freedom to the enslaved, and change the course of this country. When they took to the streets, capes on their backs, they marched to unlock the latent powers in every man in cities across this country. They became the most influential political movement ever. They got the most revolutionary president in American history elected and got him to end slavery when no one else would. You can move through time to any moment and see the same crimes, the same victims, the same villains, just different names, different faces. But you'll also find heroes. Let's take another trip to today, but 160 years in the future. There aren't forces. There aren't yet victims, no genocides committed, just a blank slate and opportunity. This is today. And regular people like you and me are using our very real superpowers to prevent history from repeating itself. The Wide Awakes has officially been reinstated. We're fighting to bring power back to the people. To end the senseless killing. To wake us up from this American nightmare and make an American dream that's real and for all of us. So today is the day. What we do today, tomorrow, next month, next year, will shape this country and our world 160 years from now. Now that's power. We don't fantasize about superpowers we don't have. We stand tall in the ones we do. We're living like T'Challa, fighting for our people, for our freedoms, for all our futures. I'm Black Thought. My eyes are open. My cape is on. Now let's move.
Wow. Okay. Those were some very, very intense, very meaningful videos. The Black Thought video obviously makes you think a lot. And I was just thinking about what Michael K. Williams was saying before that, about, you know, feeling that your vote doesn't matter and how people are banking on you feeling that way. And I know exactly how that feels. I pretty much felt that way up until this summer. I wasn't a very political person. And then I saw what was happening, obviously, with this whole entire summer, everything that transformed a lot of people's mindsets and their worldviews. And I saw that how action can make a difference. And that's I'm really happy that that's what these people are talking about. What they're trying to channel here is that, like, action is what gets people's attention. And if it didn't matter, then obviously people wouldn't be taking that away from you. So super interesting. Thank you, Michael K. Williams, for those words of wisdom. Holding it down in New York City, as someone from New Jersey, you know, I guess I'm not really from the city, but I would say I do love that city. And, you know, we're highlighting events from coast to coast on our event map with votewith.us, vote with us. Very clever URL there, you know. So check out that website. See what's happening from coast to coast. We have many friends who've invited us into their homes to see what they're up to. And right now we're going to stop in on our friend Sherry Cola and her friends, because she's hosting her very own Bring Your Own Ballot Party, some new concept I've never heard of before. Let's go check out what that looks like. What is that?
Yo, I'm Sherry Cola, comedian and actress on your favorite show, Good Trouble. And I want to welcome you to my BYOB party. That stands for Bring Your Own Ballot, of course. And I have some guests joining me, my fellow AAPI peers. We're going to talk about why we need to use our voice as a community in this upcoming election. I'm waiting for them to show up, and I hope they brought some yummy Asian snacks. Looks like my first guest has arrived. Ronnie Chan, thanks for being here, my dear. And you're part of the Daily Show, of course, so you're no stranger to the topic of politics. And historically, you know, only 49% of our Asian American Pacific Islander community showed up in the 2016 election. So I'm curious, why do you think we've been so removed from politics?
I think it's very easy to leave the work to other people, especially, you know, I think our daily lives, we can feel very busy, usually kind of balancing work and family and all this stuff. So it's very easy to kind of think of that stuff as very removed from our daily reality and kind of leave it to other people to do. But I think also in America, you know, we're kind of like a land of a lot of freedoms. And one of the freedoms, in my opinion, unfortunately, is the freedom to not care. And sometimes people just want to exercise their freedom of like, hey, I don't want to participate in this thing, you know? And I think the message which I would like to get across is that like have civic responsibility takes work, and you get out what you put in. And you can't just, if you keep leaving it to other people to make decisions for you and how the place you're living in is run, you know, eventually it's not going to look like a place you want to be in.
Exactly. And I feel like people are finally realizing that, especially with within our community, that for so long, it's almost as if we fed into the stereotype, right? Of like, I don't want anything to do with it. That has nothing, you know, to concern with me. Like, you know, our parents like escaped their countries to almost maybe not deal with politics.
I think so. I think Asian minorities in America, again, I think it's very easy if you're an Asian person in America to feel like this, I don't have a voice anyway. So why? Because I don't see myself represented in the media, in government, in any leadership positions, in the corporate world. So it's kind of like, I'm not part of that anyway. My voice isn't heard anyway. So why even bother? And it's very easy to be cynical, is what I'm trying to say. You know, it's harder work to be optimistic and to fight for a vision and to fight for what you want. You know, that's harder. And I think I would like to see more people inspired to fight harder. And I think you're right. There's a lot of organizations now kind of mobilizing people. And it's a very thankless job, by the way. Mobilizing people, organizing people. Have you tried to organize a dinner? How thankless that you're trying to get eight people to come to one place to have fun is already a huge pain. Much less trying to organize a community of people to fight for your future is incredible. Right. So my point is, like, when people provide rallying points to organize, you know, the least you can do is, if you agree with the organization, is to pitch in and give your little 1% of effort to help that, you know, to help that organization achieve its goals.
Yeah. Yo, what's up, guys? It's your boy AK.
It's your boy EJ.
And we are the Cover Boys. We're voting early this year.
Yes, sir.
We wanted to remind you guys to do the same thing.
Go do that.
And yeah.
And today we're going to be singing Come Through by Jeremy Zucker.
Yep.
Hope you guys like it. If you know it, sing along. If you don't, act like you know it.
Yeah.
All right. One, two, three, four.
I might lose my mind. Waking when the sun's down, riding all these highs, waiting for the calm down. Walk these streets with me, I'm doing decently, try that I can breathe, yeah. I'm trying to realize it's alright to not be fine on your own. Now I'm shaking, drinking all this coffee. I'm lost in my imagination, and there's one thing that I need from you. Can you come through?
And vote with us. Thank you guys so much.
We'll see you when we see you.
And yeah,
deuces.
So we are with Vote With Us, our Vote With Us national tour, March on sponsoring it. We're out here with the Voter Protection Corps. We are out here to encourage voters with voter comforts. What that means is we're here to make sure that people can get water, they get snacks, we make sure they get PPEs. We want people to vote safe. We want them to know that their rights are protected, and we want them to know that March On is here to protect them.
The vote is not sufficient, but it's necessary. If I can be a part of mobilizing the largest early voter turnout in American history, that's a win.
I'm the most inspired when we go to the college campuses. For the reason that our young people need to know, this is a must. Going to these polls, making your vote count. So I'm the most inspired by going to those places.
Our tour is going throughout the Southeast. I mean, I think the fact that we can take our tour bus from Texas all the way to Mississippi and Louisiana, and we've been welcomed. We are going to be partnering with the Medgar Evers Community Foundation, and that's going to be great in Jackson. We're going to Birmingham. We're partnering with the first Black mayor in Montgomery. You know, this is 2020. Things are changing, and we're super excited about that. And March On is a part of that movement.
Coming off of quarantine, a lot of people are mentally drained, physically drained, and emotionally drained. And what this work does, and what this work draws in terms of amazing people, is energy. We've marched, we've protested, and now we vote.
We love to see it. So much support and love at the polls with the March On bus tour. And I just want to talk about a little bit what Ronnie Cheng was saying earlier about how it's easy to leave all this stuff to other people. And we have the freedom to not care. And I'm really happy that the March On bus tour is, you know, going forward and they have the freedom. Then they're taking exercising the right who care, you know. And, you know, it really is about you getting out what you put in. And that's what we're doing here, where everyone here is coming in, contributing, trying to put a little more in, trying to get a little more out of the system that we have for ourselves. So remember, you have options when you're voting. And the most important thing is have a plan to vote. So whether that's in person on election day or better yet, early in person, if you can do that, I think knowing how to vote and when your state's voter registration deadlines are coming up, keep track of all of that. Know where to drop your ballot. That's all super critical. And at the Vote With Us website, www.votewith.us, you can get all those tools, including a tool we have called Ballot Ready, which will provide state-by-state guidance based on where you live about all the info you need on your ballot. So make sure you can grab those resources there. And now some words of inspiration from Russell Westbrook.
Rockets family, we miss you this year at the Toyota Center. We miss your love, your support, and your cheers. But no pandemic can stop us from our biggest game of the year. And that's
there are those who are preparing. One.
years ago, students from Texas Southern Universities sat down at those lunch counters at the wine gardens and said this type of racial inequity wouldn't be tolerated in this city. It started right on this campus with students from this campus. Former Congressman John Lewis was the youngest person to speak at the March on Washington in 1963. And what he said is that the greatest force to bring about that revolution is through the polling place, through your vote.
We must march to the polls like never, ever before. We must not be silent. We must stand up, and speak out.
We can demonstrate, we can protest, but if we don't take it to the polling place, then we will fall short of what we need to do. Your vote happens to be your voice.
Case time, Houston, you could vote at your basketball arena.
That's right, early voting is happening now through October 30th and on Election Day, 7 days a week.
7 a.m. to 7 p.m.
Remember to bring your ID and wear a mask. Yo, get out to vote, Houston, H-Town!
Amazing, amazing. And at this point, we want to remind you that related to the conversation we saw earlier with Emma Gonzalez on gun violence, the film Us Kids is coming out. And we really want to hype that up. That's going to be available after this live stream, actually, on YouTube. So really go check that out. Check out the amazing work that these activists in Florida have been doing related to gun violence. I'm sure you were all aware of what was happening at the time and you were following all of that. And now this film kind of puts that all together. So we really want you to check that out. And speaking of gun violence, after after this, we're going to be moving on to Alex King and the Peace Warriors, who have been fighting against gun violence in his hometown of Chicago for years. And he joined ranks with the March for Our Lives movement following this incredible speech on the stage that day. So we're going to have a conversation with him and Vic Mensa.
The day I lost my nephew, I started to really give up. But there's this principle by Dr. King, and it states, the beloved community is the framework for the future. So family, let's continue to fight for what's right.
Wow, man, that's powerful. This is from your new film, Us Kids?
Yes, it is.
I can't wait to see it. Thank you for being here.
Oh, no, thanks for having me here. And that part of the film actually was filmed at the march, which you were there, I'm aware of. Right. And 2 years later, the fight still continues.
100%.
Right, facts. Me and my friends from Parkland, thinking back, it's 2 years ago, we created a movement, and now we still need that movement any more than ever, actually. With 2020 alone, the loopholes, everything that we've been through, that we continue to go through, black and brown youth alone, that's why it's important that we do this, to spread this message, to show that it's cool to be an activist, it's cool to fight for your community, to want and see change. That's why, me personally, I encourage everybody to vote. Vote early. If you can't vote, educate yourself and those around you, because we need it. Without further ado, I will be introducing another pillar in my community who's doing great things. He will be showing off his new single, No More Teardrops, and he's not by himself. He's with the Chicago State University Marching Soul of Chicago Drumline.
And why that?
Police.
cars on fire in the streets. Tear gas and the dogs on the leash. The scene seems like Selma in the 60s. They took the knees like Monica Lewinsky. They beating women like Bobby did Whitney. SWAT only blues, we salute us to Nipsey. Juneteenth barbecue at the precinct. Hanging by the pigtails, burn down Wendy's. Strange fruit still swinging from the trees. White folks protesting because they can't leave. 25 to life, that's a real quarantine. They just take the mask off when they can't breathe. But we got officers' knees and our esophagus. Face blue because he running out of oxygen. Got his brains blew by one of his accomplices. Had you to the list of his accomplishments. Came for us in the night, now we mourning. Black fist up to the no, not warrants. But the fascism ain't the only army warring. Look at the way the patriarchy took Jordan. Look at the blood the streets filled with teardrops. I ain't slaving for him, I ain't about to share crop. Pissed off, my wrist lock and grip lock. I'm with the shits, nigga, till the bullshit stop.
No more teardrops.
Seeing niggas at the funeral. Tired of learning my homie's name at the eulogy. I'm tired of wearing suits, this ain't suitable. I'm tired of running, but 12 keeps shooting me. Niggas die, man, we still buying jewelry. Nigga, this ain't the time for the tomfoolery. A sign of the time, shit ain't what it used to be. I throw a hoodie on, look at what they do to me. 223 cop, don't need a handout. This is Wall Street, we got a bailout. They try to tell us to believe in the government, but even with Barack as president, niggas had a sale box. One out of 15 niggas in the cell block. The other 14, nobody care about. I'm in the courtroom pulling my hair out because I get another year for each one of my dreadlocks. Times you gotta fight back and get your life back. If you fight back, you might get your life jacked. Just to fight back, you gotta have a right stack. Because any cop will go hit you with the price tag. Malcolm X, you ain't new, they don't like that. Hell no, they don't like that. First cop try to hit me with a knife. Think I'm reaching for my clip, I ain't going out like that.
Just powerful, honest, that amazing performance, powerful words from Alex King, from Vic Mensa, and just a great message overall. And now we're going to sort of shift the conversation and tune in to hear about the power of the Latinx community in this upcoming election. So we're going to be talking with Wilson Cruz, Francia Raisa, Carmela Zumbado, and Alicia Novoa, here to talk about their first time voting experiences and more. And they're here to spark the necessary conversation about voting within the Latinx community. So let's move over to them.
Hola, I'm Francia Raisa from Grownish. Even though 2020 has thrown some serious curveballs, it's also given us a lot of time to think about voting, the races and values that matter to us, and finding ways to connect with each other around a common purpose. So I am super excited to be bringing some of my Latinx peers together to talk about our community's relationship to voting and our plan to make our voices heard this year. So I'm new to organizing, so I'm here with Alicia Novoa. an activist with Future Coalition, to give us a scoop on educating, mobilizing, and motivating voters.
The Southern states challenged the Voting Rights Act immediately in the courts as unconstitutional, but they fail. The Supreme Court upholds the law 8-1.
If you frame the argument, who doesn't believe that people should be allowed to vote? While there will be some people that will raise their hand, most Americans believe that citizens should be allowed to vote.
The bill that I will sign today extends the temporary provisions of the Act for 7 more years and broadens the provisions to bar discrimination against Spanish-speaking Americans, American Indians, Alaskan Natives, and Asian Americans.
The Voting Rights Act began with the former Confederate states, but this was a law that understood that discrimination could crop up anywhere. The state of Arizona was such a bad actor that in 1975, the U.S. Justice Department added Arizona to the process because of their long history of discrimination against Latinos and Native Americans.
Hispanics were facing some of the same kind of things in Arizona, in Texas, across the Southwest, that African Americans face in the segregated South. Things like literacy tests, voter intimidation. They said, we need protection under the Voting Rights Act as well.
All right, cool. So yeah, we will be, there was a little bit of a glitch there. We will be trying to get that Latinx Block Party clip coming back in for you. But that clip you just saw was from the documentary All In the Fight Democracy, directed by Lisa Cortez and Liz Gargus. This film chronicles the history of voter suppression and everything we can do to protect our right to vote. And it's produced by Stacey Abrams, featuring the story of her Georgia gubernatorial race, as well as other movement leaders in this fight to protect our most fundamental right, which is voting. And, you know, now more than ever, when democracy and other fundamental rights are at stake, we need everyone standing up in the streets and at the ballot boxes to make their voices heard. And that's what this is all about. So shout out to March On, shout out to Future Coalition, who were two leading organizations behind the climate strikes in 2019. And now I'd like to bring in our second host of the afternoon slash evening, depending on where you are. It is Bree. Welcome.
What's up, Karin? Everybody watching at home. Karin, you did such a great job with all this live event. You know, we got moving pieces. It's Mercury retrograde. You're killing it, buddy. Good job.
Oh, I appreciate that. I appreciate that.
And you're at USC. I'm here in Los Angeles, and I'm so excited to take over. Y'all, to that end, we're about to go live to an activation taking place in Miami, because that's what this is all about, doing our work to support each other, mobilizing our communities to move forward. And we don't want to forget, you got to visit VoteWith.us, vote with us, to see what activations are going on in your communities. So many people are going out to the polls this election. More than 500,000 young people have already cast their vote early and absentee ballots in the 2020 election, and it is our collective responsibility that creates this type of impact. The Vote With Us site, you can find all the resources you need to make a plan to vote early. But right now, let's see what's going on in Miami.
Tons of voters. Hey. Do you have your James?
Hi, Graham Terrard, a longtime volunteer and activist in the city of North Miami. Right here we have Sandy, and we're going to be speaking to you all today. Sandy, let's take a look at Pastor Jodia.
I'm Jodia, new activist, took fall inside North Miami. Nous invitons tout le monde pour venir voter. Nous avons encouragé à voter pour comprendre que c'est pour participer dans ce qu'on fait aujourd'hui. Comme citoyens qui habitent dans les États-Unis, si vous n'avez pas voté, c'est le dernier jour de la chute dans un coin. Mais si vous voulez pour participer, pour voir tout ça, vous voulez, vivre dans la municipalité, dans notre Miami, c'est pour sortir aujourd'hui pour voter.
Oui, d'accord. Et là, nous avons Spencer. Spencer, vous pouvez enregistrer pour voter. Ça, c'est combien pour voter, pas vrai?
Oui.
Explique-nous pourquoi ça, c'est très important.
Ça, c'est très important parce que tout le monde, ensemble, besoin de venir pour changer la communauté avec le contenu.
Oui. So you heard it here first from the city of North Miami and its residents. We're here to vote. We're here to get out the vote. We urge everyone to come out and vote with us. Back to you, Chris.
Coming this way. We've got plenty of folks out here. We've got folks all out here registering people to vote.
Hi, guys. I'm Ariel with Head Count. We are a nonpartisan voter registration organization. And voting is so important because so many people fought and died for our right to vote. And not only that, but 11,000 people turn 18 in the U.S. every single day. So if 11,000 people think that their vote doesn't matter, that could change the course of an entire election. So it's incredibly important to vote, and your vote matters.
All right, keep going. So we've got people everywhere here. As you can see, we've got folks standing out here. We've got our labor leaders. Yes, ma'am, would you like to introduce yourself?
Hi, I'm Deborah Dion. I'm with the South Florida AFL-CIO. Just really happy to be here today. This is a great turnout. Hopefully we'll see this all over the state and all over the country. We are in an economic and healthcare crisis right now. We have to make sure that Joe Biden and Kamala Harris win this election. We have to pass a minimum wage. The unions have been out, you know, fighting. Phone banking, literature dropping, knocking doors. We are out there just like you guys, and we're going to win this thing on Election Day.
Thank you so much. Let's show you some more places over here. Hey. You got tons of labor leaders right
here. Hi, how are you? Manny Hartman, South Florida LACLA, chapter president here in Miami, Florida, in North Miami. Watching our folks coming out to vote today.
Can you tell us about the excitement that's going on here?
What I love, the diversity, race, ethnicity, age, sex, it's wonderful to see the diversity and the people coming out to vote and exercising the right that many people gave the ultimate sacrifice for. We cannot forget about that. I'm privileged and so happy to see the turnout. The weather is nice. It's not raining yet. Hopefully it will not, so it's not as hot and muggy right now. We need to stress the importance to please come out to vote. If you haven't already voted, please vote. And another thing, there's a lot of folks that aren't able to vote. Get with someone that unfortunately cannot vote and vote for them if you have not already voted. Thank you.
Perfect. As you can see here, we've got tons of folks. Polls are still open here. We've got folks on the other side still coming in. Look at all the cars that are here. Folks are already in line. Miami's packed. People are really excited to get out and go vote. I think we'll go back to DJ A1 here.
Dis-moi quelle langue tu parles quand tu fais l'amour. Préjugé qui est sur la terre, fait que les hommes ils partagent en vivre. Problème religion, problème couleur, on fait oublier sinon c'est fait. Et pourtant les nappes calcées, c'est un seul homme dans toute ta vie. Son seul façon nous fait des
fois de volontiers, son seul feeling, son seul feeling.
Voting is a
privilege and a right, and I am exercising that right right now, filling out my absentee ballot, but we have to vote early and vote safe. So grab your friends, your family, grab your mask, and head to the polls as early as you can, or to the mailbox to drop off your ballot. You do not want to miss out on the polls this year. This is one of the most important elections of our lifetime. And if you go to votewith.us, you can find a vote early event close to you, so you can vote early, safe, and vote together.
Attention, ladies and gents, and all those in between. It's your gal, Showbiz Spitfire, Paige Turner. Please fasten your seatbelts, because I'm here to drag you to the polls. There's a turbulent road ahead of us, but all you Gensers, Xers, TikTokers, and ABCs are the key to helping us make a smooth departure. Drag to the Polls as an organization under the Vote With Us umbrella, dedicating to creating a safe space for queer people to vote. We have amazing events all over the country, online or in person, and socially distanced, of course, where you can party with people just like you and make a difference for your country. Oh, would you like some complimentary freedom and fun?
Hey guys, I'm gonna vote.
No, you can't.
It's me, voter number 2012.
You know, this just isn't possible. In fact, it could be, you know, you don't know exactly the consequences of you walking in there looking like that. Because what if they can't tell what your face looks like? You hand them your ID, you're about to get into this center, you're about to really do it. And because of what you're wearing, they're like, sir, we can't identify you. You can't.
What's wrong with this? Oh, you mean this?
Oh, yes. Yeah. I mean the disguise-esque apparel.
Yeah.
Do it. They need to know who we are and what we look like in this instance so that we can really make sure our vote is counted and that we are accounted for.
Okay. All right, so I think I got all this so far. So I want to use blue or black ink. I want to come up with a plan for election day with or without my mother. I want to call people like my mother to tell them how to vote and how safely to vote. I want to make sure that I look like myself when I go to vote and not like somebody who's never worn a mask before. And I also want to use my old signature, the signature I've always used, not my 2020 signature, not the new one I wanted to try out on you. Finally, after I've done all this, the one thing left to do is snap a selfie with my ballot. I'm going to put my ballot up and I'm going to take a picture of who I voted for and I'm going to share it with everybody. I'm going to share my ballot picture and I'm going to put it up on the internet.
Stop. You can't. You need to understand that is like sacrilege. This is an intimate process between you, your idea of democracy, and that ballot. And, you know, if you really want to show the world how much you care about voting, just take a picture with your sticker that says, I voted specifically for these reasons.
Today, I want to honor the Native American women of the Iroquois Confederacy who truly inspired the suffrage movement. It's been 100 years since women were given the right to vote, and our ancestors fought so hard for us. So I hope you will vote, because when we vote, we rise. And this is my song, American Dream. Of the American I've been scared of that thought too. In a world of struggle, what are we gonna do? I hear you every day saying it's gonna be okay. But hate can't be the face of the American dream.
Everybody, Renee Montgomery here, the WNBA. And so listen, Vote With Us wanted me to talk to you guys for a second. So I live here in Georgia, and as you can see, we have early voting locations, State Farm Arena being one of them, and I'll be volunteering there. But as we're going to the polls, as we're voting early, first of all, I want to tell everybody, you should know by now, but please, please, please bring your ID. Secondly, do some research before you go. We want everybody to vote all the way top of the poll to the bottom, I mean, top of the ballot to the bottom of the ballot. So as you're going through, you might not know names if you don't research it beforehand. I can guarantee you, you won't know everyone if you don't research ahead of time. So before you go, do some research, know who you're going to vote for so you can have a say in your community. You can have a say in democracy and have your voice be heard.
Vote. Important day. Time to get ready. Can't wait to tell you where I'm going. Just pausing for delicate eyeliner.
Hey, how you doing?
Focus. I can't focus because I'm too excited.
I can finally tell you where I'm going. I'm going to the polls, yeah, to go vote early, yeah, because my voice matters too. And I'll say the same thing to you. My voice matters, and so does yours. So let's come together for the sake of our democracy, put on our masks, and go to the polls to vote early. Vote with us. I forgot my dress pants.
Hello, everybody. Uzo Adubi here, and welcome to this Zoom block party. I am joined this afternoon by Cliff Albright and Latasha Brown, who are phenomenal activists. touring across the country on the Black Voters Matters bus. And we are grateful to have them in conversation to discuss all of the things that they are championing and making sure happen by Election Day across the country. So without further ado, Latasha and Cliff. Hi, you guys. First, I'd love to ask you.
Oh, how are you?
I'm very well, thank you very much. Where are you now and where are you headed?
We are in Memphis, Tennessee. So we're in the great city of Memphis. We have been here all day. Matter of fact, we came on yesterday, and today we started out our day with a party at the polls. So we have a DJ, so if you hear some music out, we've got a DJ, we've got two food trucks. We've had a steady flow of voters all day long. We've been giving out t-shirts, talking to people, connecting with around six of our partnering organizations that helped to mobilize. We wanted to creating a festive environment to encourage and inspire people to come down and vote early. So we're here in Memphis, and we're now headed to Nashville, Tennessee.
On the side of the bus, Cliff, speaking of power, the bus says on the side, we got power. Can you tell people why is that message important to you?
That we got power. That we got the power to come up out of all of this. We've got the power to change the situation. We've got power to win elections up and down the ballot. We've got power to deal with this health crisis. We've got the power to work together, because what we know is that when we work together, we win. We've got the power to come up with creative solutions to even how we touch one another and organize with one another in the midst of coronavirus. That's really where the idea that we had of doing, we've had our buses now for several years, but we've now turned the blackest bus in America into the blackest fleet in America. And so along with our main bus that Latasha and I are on right now, we've got two other buses. And on top of that, we've got 32 baby buses, vans that are rotating across 12 states. Right now, as we speak, there's guaranteed to be an event going on somewhere in some state, in some community, that one of these baby buses is driving around to, leading caravans, bringing people to the polls in a COVID-safe way.
With that incredibly beautiful Black fleet that you have, what is the goal? What do you hope to achieve at the end of the day, at the end of all of these bus tours? What is like the biggest dream and the hope for it?
You know, I think the biggest dream is, you know, if I were to tell people, if anytime you see a Black Voters Matter bus, you're always going to see two words on it. It doesn't matter what campaign we're running, you're always going to see the word power and love. It doesn't matter. You always see love and power. If you don't see love and power, it's not a legitimate Black Voters Matter bus, right? Mm-hmm. That's because this organization and everything that we root our work in, Cliff and I have been very intentional about that. Those are the bookmarks, love and power. And so, you know, I want people, if nothing else, to feel, you know, this question around, you know, for the love of humanity. What if everything we were doing was for the love of humanity? The work that we're doing out here on the ground, even voting, is not for voting for voting's sake. Voting isn't the end all. Voting isn't a panacea where it's gonna solve all our problems. We're honest with our communities about that, right? But whenever we show up in a space of power that is rooted in love, things have to change. And so when we love humanity, we fight for humanity to get better outcomes. When you love human beings, you fight for human beings to get healthcare. When you love human beings, you fight for human beings to literally be able to get better quality housing. If you love children, you fight for children to get education. The point being is that part of our work is rooted in love, but actually putting that love in action and using our power and that love and action to really be able to shape the kind of environment, the kind of world we want. And so if this tour, people don't do anything else but really tap into their own power and recognize how we've got to use our power for the service of love, if they don't remember anything else, that's what is important to us. It's not going to be the candidates that change this country. It's not going to be the political parties that are going to change this country. It's going to be us. Those of us that, for the love of humanity, are willing to operate in our sense of courage to really to operate to make sure that we're radically reimagining every system in this country, that we will fight for the least of these, that we will fight for the most vulnerable, that we will literally stand in a space that we will say everybody deserves health care. What's so wrong with everybody getting health care? What is so bad about every child getting quality education? What is so terrible about who work every day of their lives getting a paycheck that they can pay their bills? That's the kind of world and the kind of nation we want to see and feel like people deserve. And so for us, we didn't come up against any hate, whether it's racism, homophobia, sexism, all those forms of oppression that literally come out of a space of hate, that if we lean into love of, for the love of humanity, we can shift that. And we think that if we can lean into that and center ourselves in that way and use our people power when it's protesting, use our people power when it's shaping a policy, use our people power when we're talking about voting, if we can do those things, then we can fundamentally change the nature, the face of this nation. And that's what we want to do.
Woo! I don't see how you're not changing communities after listening to both of you. There's no way. Thank you so much, Latasha Brown, Cliff Albright. Thank you guys for sitting down and sharing space, taking the time out of the incredible work that you're doing across the country. I thank you. Community thanks you. We're forever grateful for not just talking about it.
Hi, my name is Michael.
And I'm Tanya.
And we are the War and Treaty, and we're coming to you from Nashville, Tennessee. As an Army veteran, I can tell you right now that nothing is more important to me than fighting for our freedoms and our democracy. And we, as the American people, have a constitutional right to make sure that we utilize our power.
Yes, power to the people. That was amazing. Big thanks to War and Treaty. You see that? Goosebumps. I have goosebumps, friends. That was so beautiful. That song's going straight onto my voting day playlist, and I hope it goes on yours. Again, we're here with Vote With Us, talking about voting early, voting safely, keeping those masks on, keeping your social distancing, and having all the resources you need to do your research before you hit the polls, bringing your group of friends, your family members, whatever is going to make your voting day smooth and get you the power that you need to make the right decisions. Power to the people. I am so grateful to be here with all of you in this fight for freedom. And it's not just a state, you know, freedom is not just something, you know, it's an act, right? We act and we make choices in each and every moment. And to celebrate the way we are seeing people vote all over the country, we are here looking at these celebrations. We just saw people partying in Miami. Okay. We saw people showing up with marching bands in Georgia, and you heard from Carly Kloss, Uzo Aduba, Josh Gad with all of their tips about how to vote safely and early and today even. Get out there. What are you doing? No, watch the rest of this and then vote. Or if you feel motivated, go now. Go now. The next thing we are going to see, the next group of voters we're going to go to is the ground in Los Angeles. Skate to the polls. Skateboarding, skating in and of itself, it's a form of rebellion. Just like, you know, for those of us whose votes that they've tried to suppress then since the founding of the United States and America, voting is very much an act of rebellion in and of itself. They don't want us to vote, so we must rebel. So let's see what these skaters are up to. They're pushing to the polls in this election. They're kicking, they're grinding. And after that, we'll hear from changemakers like the one, the only, the GOAT, LeBron James. I'm here in Laker Nation, so we call him the GOAT. You know, I'm here in Los Angeles. And we're going to hear from LeBron James, James talking to youth activists who are voting for their very first time, like my co-host, Karin. It's very exciting. But right now, we're going to skate to the polls. Let's see them skate to the polls.
Hi, my name is Dave Duncan. I'm a professional skateboarder and longtime event announcer. I'm urging skateboarders across the country, please go out and vote. Make our voices heard. You can call your friends and organize a Skate to the Polls event in your town, and you can plug your event into our national map at hashtag vote with us. Remember, there's only 10 more days till we vote. Let's go right now live to the barracks in Los Angeles with Poseidon Foundation's Michaela Ramirez and friends. And remember, let's all skate to the polls and vote.
At the barracks to remind you, skaters have the power to hold politicians accountable to making positive impacts in our community. Now, all you have to do, it's easy. Grab your ballot, vote early. Remember to vote.
Change, we ask for change, and we want the people in our communities to know if we want change, we have to make it ourselves.
To know that Staples Center is going to be a polling site for voting is unbelievable, but I hope I can continue to uplift my community, just to get people to understand how important our voices are.
This is the exact spot in the universe where King James broke the Cleveland curse. And right here is where Manon Rayon broke the NHL's gender barrier. And that spot there, that's where Odell Beckham Jr. broke the law of gravity.
That is impossible.
They all made history in America's arenas. sports arenas across the country are opening for socially distanced early voting. So find your arena, vote, and make history here.
The voting process is something that is really being talked about right now amongst people of all ages.
I think that there's like this large, you know, powerhouse, which is clearly our government, right? They are the ones that vote on the policies that become the law. And I think that we need to choose someone who is ethical, who believes in the same things that we believe in. And that's the reason why I vote.
I vote because it's having them acknowledge my existence as an Indigenous person, and me still having my, you know, my foot in the pool and having my say at the table.
And also just being a climate activist, like part of my job is telling people that their one contribution to an action matters, that their one skill in a movement matters.
Our voice matters. What we want to see matters. It's our country. We have to implement the morals and the ethics that we want to see within our system.
If everyone makes a ruckus, then they're going to be forced to have to change the policy.
Yes, that was so inspiring. Oh my gosh. I am lacing up my Vans to skate to the polls as we speak. Okay. How incredible was it? LeBron James talking to young voters. It's so exciting. Our next piece, super excited, is a duo based out of Georgia, Evan Marlboro and artist Dua Lipa. Evan is a founding member of Vote Everywhere GSU, an organization that organized the first ever student-run polling location in the state of Georgia. Wow. The first one from students? Wow. As a new college graduate, Evan is the founder of Georgia Youth Poll Worker Initiative, getting poll workers, you know, historically, you know, we need poll workers to make our polls run. And this year has been super tough because of the pandemic. So Evan's work is so important. And you can check out this conversation between Dua Lipa and Evan on the importance of down ballot voting all the way down, not just the president, not just the vice president, but all the way down to those city council people, those circuit court judges. It's so important to not forget all the voter resources as well. You need to vote in your state. And you can check that out at Vote With Us. But right now, let's go to Dua Lipa and Evan Marlboro.
It's 10 days until the election. I'm trying to wrap my head around it a little bit because in the UK, you know, ballot papers are really simple. And in the US, it's a little bit more complicated. How do you approach such an overwhelming array of choices?
You got to really research. I think that's one of the biggest things, right? Every candidate on your ballot, whether it be local, state, or federal, they all have specific duties, and then they all play into these larger bodies. But I think the most interesting part about the American government system is they all intersect and have to work together on certain points. So it is a bit of a learning curve at first, but once you get used to researching your candidate, you'll start to see how you can advocate for change based off of the candidates you pick and the combination of candidates you pick as a slate.
Okay, so I guess it's not as simple as just voting for the president or voting even for the Senate and Congress. It's so let's say if you wanted to vote, for example, representatives that support police reform and ending racial injustice, where on the ballot does that change happen?
That's a great question, right? So it's actually at three different levels, right? So if you want to do specific police reform, going back to the precincts in your area, you would have to vote for like the city council, right? When it comes to police reform on the state level, right, you got to do like the sheriffs, right? The sheriffs for the counties.
Right.
And then when you go to the federal level, you can vote in Congress people and going into a president that may want to do those things as part of their platform, right? Because then what happens is you work best when you have people all throughout all levels of government that agree on the same page, right? Or at least agreeable to some of the same points. In order to achieve racial justice anywhere, is you need full support of not just the people in power, but the people who put them in power, right? Because racial justice is a societal change, And it takes more than just voting, though voting is very important. It takes a concerted effort by all citizenry to not just change policy, but to also change hearts, minds, and education.
Right. So making sure that you vote for the right person who passes on these like legislations, right?
Yes, yes. And making sure like they're willing to listen to you when you want to share your opinions about legislation, right? When you talk to elected officials, it just goes down, 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 right? The amount of people that voted just goes down, down, and down, right? You have everybody voting for president, but to your city council, that could be only like a few thousand people. So, right? So of course, you know, we all don't have the numbers to the president of the United States, right? But it's very easy to get a call to your city council person and even have conversations with them, right? I've had conversations with all my state representatives. We've gotten coffee together. We've spoken at events together. They're actually like really cool people.
Oh, that's amazing. And so what resources do you use to like find all this out or to like research who's going to be on your ballot or what their voting record is or how do we get to be friends with these officials?
So when it comes to voting, Ballot Ready is an amazing tool, right? What Ballot Ready will do is that when you type in your information based on your address, it'll give you all the people that are running for to represent your district at each office, right? So that's a great way to learn who's on the ballot. But let's say we're in, let's say next January, where everybody's inaugurated. All the information for these candidates are on their website, right? So you could easily just Google, who is my city council person? And there's multiple websites that'll tell you who that person is. And more times than not, you'll get an email and a phone number. Also, what I would say is follow them on Instagram, right? Mm-hmm. Elected officials are getting younger and younger, right?
Yeah.
And that's at all levels, right? I think my state rep from my college campus is only about 6 years older than me, right? And I'm 22, right? So they're all on Instagram now. So you can just follow them on Instagram. You know, like their pics. Oftentimes, especially if you're an activist, they'll follow you back and like some of your stuff.
That's so great. Yeah, using social media to your advantage. I guess it's so important, especially in this day and age when it's so easily to be connected with people. It's just like, why would you not go to your first point of call and really go to them for the questions that you have and really get it firsthand? And so that's an amazing idea, and I've never thought about it like that. But maybe that's something I need to do: start following some members of parliament here in the UK.
Sometimes it's not enough to ask people to change the laws for you. Sometimes you just need to step up and be the person that makes the laws yourself, right? There's so many young people. I've seen young people as old as 19 in the United States run for office.
Yeah, I guess there is no age limit to, you know, wanting to see change and or no age bracket in the sense of how old you have to be in order to be able to be the big boss is what I'm saying. I just want to say thank you so much for this chat and good luck with everything. What you do is super inspiring and I feel so lucky to have had the opportunity to talk with you. And I'm excited for everyone to watch this and hopefully, you know, we've made it a little bit more insightful and easy for people to understand how easy and how powerful their vote is and getting out there and, you know, doing the down ballot races, because it's not all about, you know, the ticking the presidential candidate, but so much more than that.
Absolutely.
Thank you so much.
Of course. Thanks for having me.
Such great info from Dua Lipa and Evan Marlborough talking about the Georgia Young Poll Workers group, voting all the way down that ballot, figuring out who your city council people are and following them on the gram. I follow mine. I see you, Mitch O'Farrell, my local city councilman. So important. Such great information. I love how Evan said that, you know, perhaps it starts with voting, but maybe it leads to you running for politics your own self, you know. Such a great way to start engaging with local organizations. In this next chunk, more great info. We're going to be talking to young voting activists, people who may be voting in their first election this year, maybe are not even eligible to vote yet, but are motivating other people to get moving, to take their power and to you know, fight for the justice, fight for the freedoms that they want in the future. So we are going to hear from Langston Saint and Norman Lear during the Road to Change tour. They were two summers ago. March for Our Lives made stops in more than 50 cities and towns across America. This is 2018. And town halls drew in kids from all over the state wanting to get involved there. We're also going to hear next Youth Versus Apocalypse. They are a group of young activists, and they're going to be performing for us right now. Enjoy it.
We have the power, and when they try to silence us, we just speak louder. So I'ma keep on fighting till you see my power. Not gonna break down, but build a barren tower. Cause I'm a bright flame and never less than ember. And I'ma keep on till the last endeavor. And we can save lives, be allies, save our planet together.
Get up and fight, it's time to make the world right. This a long time coming, we've been fighting since the genocide of the native people. Then they stole my kinfolk off the mother soil. Look outside, you know this the time. If we don't fight now, then we won't survive. Act for your ancestors, I'm acting for mine. If it wasn't for their might, this wouldn't be the time.
Get up and go, get up and vote.
We only out of time when we lose hope.
It's time to fight.
When they try to silence us, we just speak louder.
I'm the one who gets targeted by racism, sexism, violence, but most of all, white silence. From the lowlands to the highlands, come on, y'all, we can do better than that. Let it be known, it's in your bones. Use your vote for a good reason.
El poder está en las palmas de tus manos. Es bien claro, hay que aprender, usarlo a votar. Ahí nos vamos. Get up and go, get up and go. No matter how you do it, but you're voting for the earth. Voting for the people who ain't got a chance to vote. Deprived for the matter, cause they're scared about my vote. You talk about collective liberation and show the support. Been had the conversations like you're ready to implore. To say the world, we can't do it alone. So pick your butt up. Then pull up to the polls.
Get up and go. Get up and vote.
Votar es importante. Había mucha gente que no lo podía hacer antes. Las mujeres y la gente de color salieron a la calle, protestaron con valor. Mucha gente marcharon, mucha gente peleó por el derecho de votar. Mucha gente murió, so dime tú, ¿cómo se sentirían si su esfuerzo fue en vano? Ellos lucharon, pero el derecho no lo utilizamos. Hay que votar, tenemos que sacar al presidente actual de la Casa Blanca. Tu voz tiene que abusar, no te puedes callar. Recuérdala a tu vecino, juntos lo vamos a lograr.
To spend billions of dollars on weapons and call it protection. Fossil fuels, chopping trees, these are the weapons. Oceans rising like my anxiety. Increase in heat, increasing my thoughts, I cannot think. I am impatient. I want to live in a nation where my leaders actually lead. They see our lungs are being filled with the last breath from burning trees. Drowning in ashes, more flames than people. Soon the ratio between living things and air will be unequal. Is this the world you want us to live in? You say I'm so inspirational. Sit in a seat of power and still create no change. I don't just want to be inspirational. I want you to do what we demand.
To stop violence, this can't just be a Chicago thing, a Parkland thing. We need everyone to come together, talk to each other, vote.
The biggest reason it's extremely hard to pass gun legislation in this country, and it starts with three letters, it's called the NRA. This is not about swinging districts from red to blue or blue to red. It's about swinging districts toward morally just leaders.
You're not on the panel. Please go to the back room. Do you have a panel?
We are currently dealing with the best problem, which is there are way too many people here.
$11,000.
This year was $11,000.
I really realized that it's my obligation to tell people what me and the young population care about, because the young people aren't able to vote yet. We aren't going to ban all guns, but we do need to ban certain guns, and we do need to make more strict policies about who can get those guns. It's their job to protect us, and they're not doing their job correctly.
Terrific, Langston.
Thank you.
So how old are you now?
That clip was recorded 2 years ago, and now I'm 12.
And now you're 12. So I am 86 years 86 years older than you. And I am Langston in terms of my point of view and conviction also. So we share that, buddy. Age or new age. I think one of the great gifts of being alive and well in this country is that vote. I don't have the words to express the degree of privilege and excitement I feel about that single vote, just my single vote.
I'm absolutely looking forward to the time when I will be able to vote to cast an official voice in an election. Well, it's something that basically ever since I've gotten interested in politics has been a very exciting goal for the future.
I love hearing that. It's pretty exciting being an American and with that privilege, isn't it?
Yeah.
I know the organization that we're addressing, you and I, Langston, is Vote With Us. Am I right about that?
To me, Vote With Us means that that people who have the voice, who have the vote, they have the voice and the power to do what all of us young people want.
Yes.
And I think that America will be around as long as that spirit is still with us.
And as long as that vote is there for each of us to vote our conscience exactly the way we feel it.
Will they be proud of us? Will they know that we did everything that we could? That we worked harder? We didn't give up? Will they know that we did it for them? That we woke up earlier. We stayed longer. We sacrificed. That we were relentless until the last day. They will. They will know. Because they are watching. Let's do this. Vote.
Yes, do it for the kids. These young activists, wow, how incredible. 12 years old, Langston Saint. When I was 12, I was eating cereal. and watching cartoons, and that's it. This is incredible. Youth versus Apocalypse, spitting all kinds of bars about the meaning of voting, about how, you know, voting, if you don't vote, it impacts marginalized folks and how important their voice is to be heard. You know, you really have to take your power back and get out there right now. I mean, gosh, 12 years old, 14 years old, they can't vote, but they know that this change is going to really impact their communities, and they're just getting started. Sorry, I'm microphone issues, but I would love to hear what you are doing in your families, communities, friend groups to get your friends out to vote. Hit us in the chat. Let us know what your tips are. I'll tell you what, I texted my family group chat. I said, what do you need me? How can I support you to get your vote out? It doesn't have to be political. It doesn't have to be, you know, even a partisan message, but just showing your support for your friend groups. We love to see it. Coming up next, we're going to pop back in to Sherry Cola's BYOB voting party. Speaking of getting your friends involved in the action, and we're going to see what's going on, who she's talking to, and what they're snacking on. She mentioned Asian snacks. We need to see what the snacks are. So Sherry Cola, let's go back to your voting party now.
Jeremy Lin! What a surprise!
Oh my God, is that Jeremy Lin?
That's the one and only Jeremy Lin.
What's up, Ronnie?
He's taking five. He's taking five from the court to spread that good word about voting. And I was just talking to Ronnie about, you know, our AAPI's community, you know, participation in the election. And truly, Jeremy, with, you know, our endless battle with representation, or really the lack thereof, and everything we've gone through this year alone with COVID and just the incidents in the news. I mean, why do you think now more than ever we have to use our voice and make our votes count?
After Linsanity, seeing how people would characterize me or make assumptions of me, or even the jokes or all the things, I was like, you know what? Maybe this isn't the world that I had envisioned or thought that it was. But I had to kind of learn, and I'm still learning, okay, how do I step it up from a civic engagement or a political standpoint? How do I educate myself and be a bigger part of that? And that's why I'm trying to do this. I'm trying to learn more is... you know, I know that Asians are really underrepresented, maybe the most underrepresented group potentially in the census, in voting. And I think at the end of the day, if we're not doing what we need to be doing to make our voices heard, we can't complain when they're not heard. And we can't expect other people to like magically listen or know what we're thinking or what we want, unless we actually go and do that ourselves. But at this point, in this juncture, like we've seen the political turmoil, we've seen the racial tensions, like we don't have time to stand by and like hope that things get better. Like we have to go do something ourselves, and like we can no longer be one of the most underrepresented groups. I think that we need to rally together, we need to do big things, and we need to stand up for what we believe is right. And at the end of the day, if that doesn't work, we can accept the fact that we tried and we didn't get the results we wanted, but let's just not have it be because we didn't put in the work.
Virtually overnight, African Americans are eliminated from the electorate in the South. So you go from having Black governors and senators to having almost no, if not any, Black voters that were able to participate in elections.
In Mississippi, during Reconstruction, African American voter registration was almost 67%. By the time we have fought the Nazis and we are moving into the Cold War, where the U.S. is really holding up as the leader of the free world, only 3% of age-eligible African Americans were registered to vote in the South. 3%.
Percent. incredible info. I hope everybody is enjoying the events of the day. I want to shout out to some of the folks who are coming through the chat to let us know that Jessica Ann got three of her Florida roommates to vote early, and they didn't vote in 2016. Those are notches on your belt. That's not an expression. Jessica Ann, great job. You count those, girl. You got them. Janiket and Lisa M talking about their 78-year-old dad and their cousin both voted, and they're, you know, in communication. You're confirming your family members have voted. So powerful. And it's so empowering to feel like you are, you know, motivating your community to make stuff happen. Love to see it. We are going to go live now to Detroit, where we're going to meet Andy Didio Rossi from the Detroit Bus Company, and they're giving free rides to the polls from now until election day. So if you're in Detroit, you've got to watch and figure out how to get your free ride. And then after that, we're going to hear from Jacqueline Corin and Rosario Dawson. Jacqueline joined a number of students to co-found what would become March for Our Lives, and she was the organizing backbone in those early days, still continues to fight for social justice. But first, let's go straight live feed from Detroit.
Very good. No, they want...
That's fine.
Yeah, this looks good. Let's see.
You like your frame?
Yeah. Is this for us?
Okay. Little bit of an issue there. But we're going to be back in a second to see if we can make that happen. Let's go to that Jacqueline Corin and Rosario Dawson conversation, March for Our Lives, and other organizing tools so that we can get voting and get our power into our communities.
So, Emma, what is the plan? You say you want to spark a national movement. It's one thing to talk about it. It's another thing to actually make it happen.
We're going to be doing a march on Washington where we get students all over the country are going to be joining us.
Everyone in the world knows about this.
About March 24th.
It's about March 24th.
Welcome to the Logan Love Conference Center.
I never was on a conference call before all of this. And I was like, who's speaking? Like, who am I talking to? I can't recognize voice from voice.
You're never not working, are you?
No.
We were up until like midnight every night.
The people who were skeptical, they said, oh, there's no way these kids got that city permit and built that stage. You're completely right. I did not build the stage. I just had to sit on two-hour conference calls discussing those things where I wanted to tear all of my hair out. What had started in that little bedroom was now so much bigger than us. It was like the world was a video game and we knew the codes.
I mean, I'm so blown away. You spoke about so many important things that are critical for getting from that stage of experience and trauma to organizing and creating action around it. That's advocacy and healing. You know, I find a lot of therapy in doing this kind of work. But how did you go from organizing Florida and being in Florida politics to then really kind of branching it out around the country and really ultimately around the world?
Mm-hmm, definitely. I think, you know, the realization that we knew we had to involve voices that, you know, experience gun violence on an everyday basis, primarily members of the Black and Brown communities all around the country. We realized that fairly quickly. And so in preparation for the march, we started connecting with young, you know, organizers and activists all around the country, and really doing research into, you know, youth-led groups that have been doing this work for a long time, because we weren't going to, you know, say, oh, we, you know, started the gun violence prevention movement, because that's not what we did. We, you know, just wanted to enter into a space that's already been cultivated.
Can you speak a little little bit about it. I mean, you started this off in the very beginning, having that initial conversation, and then all along the way doing your travels, you were going and registering people to vote, tens of thousands of people. We're in an election year. You know, it's really critical, I think, that we give that information to people, because sometimes voting is the first step that people do take towards advocacy and action.
You know, we have really do have the power to, you know, sway elections. So it's imperative that young people register, you know, especially if your state is still allowing that. It's imperative that you go early vote or vote on election day and make sure that your friends are also doing that, because it's up to all of us involved, being involved in our communities and our friend groups and our families to make sure everyone else is also on board.
I'm here in sunny Los Angeles, California, where it's not that sunny, dropping off my ballot for the first time. I think it's really important that all two-spirit, queer, and non-binary Indigenous people show up to the ballots in November to make sure that your vote is counted. Well, here goes nothing.
Did you know, America? It is possible to vote safely in person this year. Just do the things you're already doing in public places to protect your health. Wear a mask, use hand sanitizer, and stay 6 feet apart from others. As an extra precaution, bring your own pen to vote. If voting in person is right for you, find out how at vote411.org. Get online, get the facts, and make your voice heard.
Yes. Lots of good info. We're dragging you to the polls, dragged out. Get your wig on and get to the polls, everybody. We do have that live feed from Detroit. We appreciate your patience. You know, it's a live event. Mercury is retrograde. A lot of moving pieces, but we've got some great people behind the scenes who are looking to connect the nation, show you what's going on. So we're going to go live to Detroit right now, where they're talking to the Detroit Bus Company about free rides to the polls. Check it out.
Okay. Okay, go for it.
Hey, everyone. I'm Andy DiDerossi, the founder of the Detroit Bus Company. We were supposed to be doing a free vote rides project this year. We did one in 2018. It was a huge success. But this year, we're not doing it, or at least not right now, because there's a new law, or it's actually an old law that's come back by the federal courts that say we're not legally able to bring people to the polls. Companies can't do it. And so the people who get most impacted by this are the people who don't have transportation to the polls, which is a total bummer. You know, I started this company to help get people to where they need to go, to jobs, to education, and to democracy, you know. So this law exists to keep people disenfranchised. It exists to keep people down. And we're the only state in the country that has a law like this. And so no matter where you are, you need to go and vote to make stuff like this less likely to happen. It's very frustrating to have an entire fleet ready to bring people to the polls, and legally we can't do it. This is normally supposed to be a day that this whole fleet is out serving people and getting them where they need to go. People with disability challenges are really hugely impacted by this. Public transit right now is not easy to use because of COVID. There's tons of challenges. So it's very important that you go and vote early. You can go to votewith.us to get more information. We can vote together that way. Find your way to your nearest early voting station or satellite office and make it happen. You know, I'm counting on you. So see you from Detroit.
A voteless people is a hopeless people. That's it. That's all I got. Because it's true. A voteless people is a hopeless people. So I hope this speech will sow a seed that'll grow a tree full of ballots before bullets start to evoke the feeble. I mean, come on. Don't you want to go toe-to-toe with evil and know it's legal? Nope. Cool. I could just go to sleep too. Then I'm complicit, letting the system in need of revision remain consistent, though I know it needs new. Everything. I'm talking about freedom. We need to let it ring. Let them see we ain't satisfied. That is why you vote. We need you. Because then there's voter suppression, which is so deceitful. It's not only gross, it's lethal. It goes to show the lengths folks will go just to control the people. And I like Drake, but we can't go back to back. 2016 can't go back to that. In other words, no to sequels. Now just think about all the great things voting leads to. Civil rights, health care, clean air, marriage equality, and now you can smoke some weed too. Because voting is more or less forward steps for the ones who couldn't before us get what was constitutionally theirs, from formerly enslaved, suffrage parades, immigrants detained, to the poorest vets. I mean, this could be America's best performance yet. But you're right. It's your right to abstain, but if you don't participate, then you can't complain. If they counterclaim or deface and maim or set aflame or start taking aim at your pursuit of happiness, your liberty, or your life. You only get one, so I guess vote to live. Yeah, vote to live.
Years and my life is still trying to get up that great big hill of hope for a destination. I realized quickly when I knew I should that the world was made of this brotherhood of man, for whatever that means. So I cry sometimes when I'm lying in bed to get it all out, what's in my head. And I'm feeling a little peculiar. And so I wake in the morning and I step outside and I take a deep breath, get real high, and I scream, what's going on? And I say, I try all the time in this institution, and I pray, oh my God, do I pray, pray every single day for revolution. And so I cry sometimes when I'm lying in bed just to get it all out, what's in my head. And I'm feeling a little peculiar. And so I wake in the morning and I step outside and I take a deep breath, get real high, and I scream, what's going on? And I said, said, hey, yeah, hey, yeah, hey, yeah, oh, hey, what's going on? And I said, hey, yeah, 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 hey, yeah, yeah, said, hey, what's going on? And I said, what's going on?
That was fantastic. Again, so many goosebumps through this live stream. That was Willa Amai with a lovely cover of What's Up. And that is about it for me as your host. I've been Bree Pruitt, a comedian and host, and I'm so excited to bring on my co-host, performer with the mostest. It's Mikhail. What's up, bud?
Oh, not much, not much. You know, just watching the stream, getting some information, as we all should be doing.
I'm pumped. I'm trying to skate to the poles right now. I don't know about you. I want to take a free ride. I want to skateboard. I'm pumped.
I know my Vans are right next to me. I'm currently shoeless though, but that's for sure.
Get those shoes on, bro. Thank you so much for taking over. I'll kick it over to Mikhail right now.
Well, hello, hello, everybody. My name is Mikhail Cooley. I am an actor and producer, director, extravaganzaire. And now we are just going to, and well, I want to tell you a little bit about Vote With Us before I start to go off. So Vote With Us is about young people and our engagement in the transformation of this country. So if you think many activists who came before us, many of them started their activism at a very young age. Take a look at this young person, Stacey Abrams, who began her fight when she was our age.
Today, I come to you as a young person, as a young woman, as a young Black woman, to ask you to use us, use the young people of the United States of America to pave a road that will last forever.
The first great protest march on the nation's capital ever was for the right to vote for women. In 1913, the day before the presidential inauguration, 5,000 women marched down Pennsylvania Avenue. It took pushing and pushing and pushing. It took hunger strikes, picketing in front of the White House, all this creative nonviolent protest that was new to this country. This was before Gandhi had done a lot of these things, but the women's movement and the fight for women's suffrage introduced them to the United States.
We get to the 19th Amendment that guarantees women the right to vote.
When you look back at how long women fought for the right to vote, we're used to movements now 10 or 20 years and the change happens. Women spent their entire lifetimes fighting for the 19th Amendment.
Black women were instrumental in the passage of the 19th Amendment. They had been part of this conversation from its beginning. Women who were helping shape opportunity for white women and for Black men. And yet, in each of these conversations, Black women were left out of the narrative.
When I think of Milwaukee and I think of Wisconsin, I think of Black women. I think of limitless possibilities.
I think of the word love. I think of the word inventive, making ways out of no ways. And I think beautiful.
We're in a moment where some pieces of our democracy are in need of repair.
Wisconsin, be strong and show up.
This state is a swing state. This city is going to also be the key of how the state goes.
Milwaukee, I love you. Milwaukee, we need you. We need you to show up at the polls. We need you to show up and ensure that your voice is heard.
The most important thing that we have to do as Black women is go out and vote.
As we go, so does humanity.
We're voting for ourselves. We're voting for our children.
We say we need you, we mean you.
Your voice matters.
The time is now. Vote.
These are the
days. And these are the times. There's no waiting anymore, 'cause it is all about us. We all know what we're looking for. So much to say. We all hope we get it right. Unspoken prayers are sign to say. It's hard to see their face, and I might not have my money right. I might not have no accolades, no tomorrow or tonight, but I'll always have today. Remember, I believe.
you. God bless.
God bless. God bless indeed. That was powerful, invigorated, matriarchs of melanin and mothers of earth and keepers of love. And that was incredibly beautiful. Make sure you support your Black women in this time by voting for and like the Black women. And as powerful as that was, we really need to take the time to honor the contribution that Black women have made to this society and this earth. And it doesn't happen enough, not nearly enough. So much of this country was built on the backs of the Black women, and it goes unnoticed more often than not. But transitioning, as we start to vision our future in this life and earth, it goes without saying how indebted we are to this as a country to Black women everywhere. Women are so powerful in their leadership and their ability to think of people beyond themselves when they make decisions and will impact the whole community, all of them. So next we have gun reform activist Sam Fuentes. She is here to talk with Amy Schumer about her mission to make sure that no child or adult is devastated by senseless and preventable gun violence ever again. Senior student Fuentes was shot with an AR-15 in her Holocaust studies class. This is such a special film. And again, we invite everyone, and I do mean everyone, all the people, to please sneak preview of this, this Us Kids film after the rally at Us Kids on YouTube for free, completely free. Now, here's a most memorable moment from Us Kids of her incredible speech at the March of Our Lives rally. I promise you will be motivated to vote after this video. Let's go right to it.
Hi, Sam Fuentes.
Hey there, Amy Schumer, how you doing?
I'm really honored and inspired to get to meet you, and I'm excited to take a look at this clip of the film that you've been a part of.
Thank you. Well, it's a pleasure and honor to have you here too.
Thank you. All right, let's take a look at this clip.
Yeah.
Okay.
I remember walking onto station back. My first thought was like, I'm in danger.
Hello, beautiful people of America. Me. I am here for you. So you don't ever have to worry about going into a Holocaust history class to learn about death and then experience it right before your eyes.
It all came down to I'm gonna get shot here right now on this stage.
Never did I think I would be herded like cattle by a shower of bullets that left me scarred and rattled, forced to huddle among those who lost their last living breaths on a day that was designated for loves and laughs. The moment we speak up, we're scolded that we are not old enough. It is as if we need permission to ask our friends not to die. Lawmakers and politicians will scream guns are not the issue, but can't look me in the eye.
I blacked out right after I threw up, but it was definitely like, I have to finish this because it's Nick's birthday. That's what I was thinking about.
But it is also the birthday of Nick DeWart, someone that was senselessly murdered in front of me. I would like to sing happy birthday. One, two, three, happy.
I always thought that Nick was better than me. You would hear his name on the morning announcements during his competitions, and we would clap for him in class anytime he'd come back. And like, it just makes me wonder, like, why? What's the difference? Like, why was I just too far? Was I too close? I don't know. It's like, I always wonder, like, why it wasn't me.
I I just have a rule in my life that whoever has shrapnel inside their body gets to talk first. So I was there that day, and I remember seeing you and just being blown away and being so inspired and just wanting to just follow your lead. And it's the March for Our Lives really for me was it was an awakening because it really felt like you guys were the ones we've been waiting for. And I realized that day that it's just up to us to follow your lead. And I want to ask you, first of all, I want to ask you about your friend, Nick. What was Nick like, and what were you guys like in class together?
Oh man, Nick was always just a joy to be around, always excited about anything, you know. He made things fun and lighthearted. He was an incredible athlete. You know, one of his big aspirations was to, you know, swim in the Olympics and, you know, represent the U.S. And he was always a really good role model for other students and always had very, you know, poignant, intelligent, but like clever things to say. And, you know, he's just the kind of person who could light up a room. And he's someone that I think about every single day. I actually was with his parents today, Annika and Mitch, and we went to vote together, you know, kind of in his honor, because this year would have been his first primary election voting. And it was mine as well. So it was a really, you know, an emotional day and one to memorialize Nick, because, you know, in this country, we need to have people who represent everyday issues and people and have solutions for issues like gun violence and all of the injustices that happen in this country. And I know that that's what he would want us to do, is to stand up and really do and make a difference for him. And that is a big reason that I'm an activist, is I'm an activist out of necessity. So I can honor those that I've lost. And the only thing that makes me feel better is, quite frankly, like working at it. And I know that's what Nick would wanted and what his parents want. And it's essentially like why I think everyone needs to be, you know, civically and politically engaged, because for many people, like this election means their lives and their safety and their well-being.
You know, we already know that there are many outcomes, but we want them to count every vote, and that we're going to be in this fight to make sure that it's fair and honest. And that's really all we want.
I want to ask both of you, are there any specific issues that will affect us and the future of our children, from climate change to housing, or anything that you guys are running in fear of, like personally?
The way that this entire country has been structured since its inception has been to benefit our white male citizens. And so I think this election is really about how we finally have a conversation about systemic racism and the way it shows up in our government.
I completely agree with you. What about you, Carmela?
I'm always very concerned for the marginalized communities of our country. I really want to see leaders in office who are going to commit to protecting LGBT community, our immigrants, everybody right now who is pushed off to the side. We've got to see leaders in office who aren't just going to make their rights a thing, but protect them and ensure those rights for future generations to come. And just like what you said, I think climate is something in the long term we really need to be making sure that we have leaders in office that are prioritizing climate concerns. And on a short-term basis, we need to kick this coronavirus pandemic in the butt right now. And we need somebody in office who is going to make sure that there are not going to be as many deaths as we foresee being estimated right now. And that's just a short-term concern that we need to make sure we have leaders in office who are going to curtail this as quick as possible.
Yeah. Absolutely. I mean, really, what it comes down to, I'm voting this year down the ballot for people who believe in science, whether that means in terms of climate change or the coronavirus. We need people who will look at the facts and make decisions based on those scientific.
Hola, América. Este año, millones de electores votarán con boletas de ausente o por correo. Eso quiere decir que el conteo de los votos será prolongado. Aunque estamos acostumbrados a conocer los resultados la misma noche de las elecciones, este año tendremos que esperar un poco más. Y eso está bien, porque todos los votantes merecen que se escuche su voz. Vale la pena esperar por nuestra democracia. Más detalles sobre cómo votar en vote411.org/ES.
That strong, strong, powerful, heartfelt messages given to us by everyone. I feel it. I love it. And my love goes out and my vote will reflect that love for sure. Next up, however, we're going to be talking about some real deal BS that's been going on for centuries to block people from keeping their power. This is called voter suppression. It's an effort aimed at blocking or discouraging a person or a group of people from exercising their right to vote. Reminder, they wouldn't be trying to suppress your vote if each vote, each and every vote, wasn't so powerful. So don't give up. Check out this video from All In. They can explain way more than I can. Let's go to it.
Voter suppression has often targeted communities that are seen as non-normative. We saw this come into sharp relief in North Dakota, where a law that required a residential address on driver's licenses seemed benign. But the reality was that for those communities, getting a residential address on a reservation required that the state or local government grant that to you, and it didn't happen.
A majority of Indian country does not have physical addresses. They use post office boxes. It became very evident that the law was created to suppress the Native American vote.
The only way to get recognition is to vote. And that's what it is. Matter of survival.
In Wisconsin, they put a new voter ID law in effect in the run-up to the 2016 election.
Yes, yes, indeed. Voter suppression has been around for a very, very, very long time, and it is not, it's never good. It's never okay. And this is why we all need to do what we can to support each other at the polls. Connect with friends and family to talk about what's on the ballot. Reach out to friends who may need a bit more guidance figuring out how to vote, figuring out where to drop off their ballots and what voter registration deadlines are in your state. Visit the votewith.us site for all these resources. So next up, we're going to hear from artists and activists Shutezcat Martinez and Miley Cyrus about how transformative social movements can be when putting political pressure on our political officers.
Can you talk about what the elections mean to you, and what would you say to people who aren't politically engaged right now? Why is it so important?
Honestly, I spent a lot of my life being really involved in social movements, but not so engaged politically. And it wasn't until the last couple of years where I realized, like, these spaces can be really transformative when people apply pressure. And one of the movements that I was really involved with is a grassroots movement to stop this pipeline from being built called the Keystone XL pipeline.
Yeah.
That happened, you know, a handful of years ago. And Obama eventually vetoed and blocked the access for this pipeline to be built from Canada across the U.S. that would have been detrimental to the climate. And it wasn't just because Obama was this great climate hero. It was because people for years put massive amounts of pressure. Indigenous communities built coalitions with farmers, with rural farmers across the United States, and really pushed really hard to get this transformative change to happen. And when we look at the political climate, young people have completely changed it, have made sure that politicians across the ballot have acknowledge the climate crisis as a top issue for our generation. We have completely pushed the entire Democratic Party closer to a Green New Deal platform, which is the comprehensive and really the only comprehensive vision for responding to this crisis through a lens of justice and equity. And I think it's really powerful for me to look at different organizations like the Sunrise Movement that is doing a lot of political organizing around the climate and seeing that these issues are not just distant issues in the future to be debated by politicians, but if we want to make sure that our voices are included, we have to apply that to the process immediately. The margins of victory that happened for Bernie's campaign in various states happened because young people turned out to vote. And when we think about, you know, what this November election particularly means, it's like there's a lot on the line, not just because of this virus, but because, as you're saying, so many of these other systemic issues that have been here for generations that have been continued to be impacted from colonialism and the enslavement of African peoples and so much intense violence, like at the foundation of this country. And for us to talk about building a brighter future, envisioning what we want the world to look like, getting politically engaged is one step in that process. And voting is like an entry level process and an opportunity for all of us to take. And we, again, have a lot of different champions that are fighting for a Green New Deal down the ballot that aren't just running for the presidential office, but for various different levels of power. And recognizing that local politics is also really important, because I think one thing we've seen with this pandemic too is there's actually a lot more local leadership that is happening in these times, even than federal leadership. Lots of states and local governments are doing their part much more than the federal government.
And that's how you make change. We talked about that on the show yesterday, is local and state, and all, when we all work together, and federal, everyone working together, that's how you actually make change.
Yes, yes, indeed. A lot of young people are turning out to vote this year. It's probably it's one of the biggest, if not the biggest, young voter turnout. And I just want to remind all of our young voters that it's about consistency as well. You know, go back and revisit these votes and follow up with your legislative, your executive, your judicial branches. Vote for all of them and vote for all of them all the time. I'm very excited to be going back live to Orlando with a performance by an incredible artist who made a huge splash this spring with My Vote Won't Count. And then this fall, they're back with My Vote Will Count. Let's go to Orlando. Just got rich, took a broken. I can make a broken. What we say today, but I don't vote. I know your girl wanna lay with. It was all about voting early. I took it to the bay. It's all about bringing awareness. White girls like Lady Gaga. Yes. Rolling up there by Molly, I'm a rasta. She wanna do drugs. Say. Smoke, get drunk. She wanna see him. We came to buy real quick, ladies and gentlemen. I bet she love all the rest. When I reach the room, won't you, won't you, baby? Wouldn't it get crazy, baby? Yeah. 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 What we say? These girls ain't loyal. No, they ain't. Yo, Nancy, where you wanna go? Bring me up. Bring me up. Ready, 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 ready.
I'm different, yeah, I'm different. I'm different, yeah.
What
I'm
you say?
Different. I'm different.
Yeah, say we
both different. Pull up to the scene with my ceiling missing. Pull up to the scene with my ceiling missing. Pull up to the scene with my ceiling missing. Pull up to the scene with my ceiling missing.
You know.
Middle finger up to my attention. I ain't need naughty, naughty,
naughty. Tell the guy to stay there. Before we start the show, let's crank it up. Crank it up. Crank it up.
Booty going up, down.
I say.
I can notice all day like it ain't.
I don't believe with you.
You know what we say?
You little stupid and game with you.
You know, I told her that this shit ain't low.
You little dumb and game with you.
Ready.
I got a million trillion things I'd rather do.
Ladies and gentlemen, coming to the stage right now, Yellow Pain.
Yellow!
Seven!
What's up with it? Yellow, let's get it started.
I know you're waiting for this one.
What's going on, Orlando? How y'all doing?
What's up?
If you're ready to vote, let me hear you make some noise.
Take it, you hear me?
And I know it's a way we can win. Why won't nobody say it?
Aye. Let me hear you.
Aye.
It don't matter where we from. Certain words are the songs. They don't want to see us win. They'd rather keep us gone.
It was three branches of the government. We forgot it when we got older. It's the judicial, the legislative, and executive. But all we know is the executive. That's the mayor or the governor and the president. Now none of them three people make no laws. They just be checking them. The laws come to their desk and all they do is say no or yes to it. So when the news station tried to tell us that Barack Obama couldn't put us on, we was all salty at Obama when it was the Congress members on the lawn. We gotta focus on the legislative branch. Yeah, they the ones that make the laws. Yeah, they the ones write how much food stamp money you get on the card. But when people that wanted to help us wanted the job, I know they probably lost. Cause we ain't even know their name, we ain't know their face, we ain't know it all. So the Congress or the State House, that's legislative, they make laws. So what we want from the president is what they do. Okay, y'all, see they election every 2 years, but we don't never even go to those. The Congress, they can raise minimum wage, but we ain't even really know it though. So you know how back in 08, when we all voted for Obama, we was all supposed to go back in 2010 and vote for the Congress. Cause they the ones make child support laws, they the ones choose if
you
can't
pay
school, get the
East State
or
court.
So if the country failed, then you can't say it's them, it's your fault. Cause y'all ain't know to vote for Congress members, that was for y'all. And they don't gotta leave after 4 years, and we just let them sit. Then they don't wanna tell you this, they want you to focus on the president. Now the third branch is the judicial, that's judges. They the reason why John Crawford and Trayvon ain't had justice. So when Meek Mill got locked up, it's for popping willies, we blame the judge and not the city. When they done heard get voted in, cause they ain't know who to vote against. Imagine life on the other side, Rosebud. School's better. Everybody get their license back. Grocery store food better. Custody of your kids back. Homeless people get new shelters. If we gon' fix the U.S., we gotta start with them two letters. Me and you. Somebody told us that the government wanna keep us broke. But the only reason why those people in the government is cause we ain't vote. And I ain't talking about the president. I'm talking about the ones we ain't know. See, they was gonna try to keep it low. But it's gonna hurt them when they see the polls.
I know the world won't give me nothing.
It's gonna hurt them when they see the polls.
Let me hear you make some noise.
We were at the biggest voting turnout in history.
Why won't nobody say
it?
Listen to it.
They don't matter where we from. Suburbs or the slums. They don't want to see us win. They'd rather keep us down.
Y'all. Love y'all.
Thank you.
Give it up, give it up. Make some noise right now, ladies and gentlemen. Make some noise right now for my dog, Yellow Pain. Seven. Yo, DJ Nasty.
Shema Dosh Jajah. That means my mother and my father brought me up and my siblings up in our Diné way of life. And I am completely blessed for that. The trail ride was actually my dad's idea. My dad is a little bit old school and was becoming really frustrated and wasn't feeling particularly motivated to vote in this election. He had this vision of all of us riding because my dad is deeply connected to his horses.
When I'm united with my horse, you know,
It's so awesome. It's just, you know, everything is beautiful.
We pulled this trail ride together today called Ride to the Poles because our Indigenous children, our Native children across the country, are feeling the urge to reconnect to our culture more than ever. And we thought this was a great way for them to feel inspired and motivated to vote in honor of our ancestors who rode longer miles to make their voices heard in voting at the polls. When one mounts a horse and is in rhythm with the horse, we feel connected, and we call that horse medicine. I wanted our people, our Diné people here in Arizona, to ride with that spirit and let it enter them and take that to the polls, because this election is one of the most important in our lives. When I vote for Indigenous peoples, I vote for protecting our land. I vote for protecting our elders, especially those who have been severely impacted by COVID-19. I vote to protect the sacred. And that, to me, means our languages, our cultures, and our spirituality. We're so divided across this country. As Diné people, we talk about restoring balance, what we call Hojon, the beauty way.
Voting with love means remembering my people, my forefathers, what they fought for, you know, to keep our land beautiful and sacred.
I wanted our people to have the horse spirit with them and part of that horse medicine before they cast their ballots today. I can see my ancestors when I look at these rock formations. I can feel their spirits. It motivates me and mobilizes me to continue fighting for our rights, Indigenous rights, and for Indigenous women and children. We're partnering with Vote With Us to make moments like this a movement. Visit votewith.us to find out what's happening in your community.
Rachel Platten. I want to dedicate my new song, Soldiers, to all of the youth activists trying to get out the vote around the country. You guys are amazing and so important, and I hope that these words remind you and remind all of us that even when we feel powerless, we are absolutely not. We have the power to make a humongous change in this country, and I believe that we can. So this is called Soldiers.
We're all soldiers on our own, trying to find our way back home. And at the end of the day, nothing matters anyway, just the love that we have made. So let's let go of our mistakes. I
What a lovely, lovely voice from a lovely being with a lovely message. And now we're going back to Orlando again to hear from the president of the Florida Rights Restoration Coalition, Desmond Mead.
When they try to do things like that to us. And we clap back by showing up and showing out. And so I want to give my brother Marquise, who got an amazing story, just a minute to share his story with y'all.
Appreciate that, Dez. What's going on, everybody? Hold on. If you voted, let me hear you make some noise. All right, so I definitely want to take the time out to say today was my first time voting in a presidential election in my life. We all know in the state of Florida, sending more juveniles to adult prison than any other state. At the age of 15, I was charged for armed robbery and sent to adult prison for my first offense. And I lost my voting rights before I even had them. So today, what today is about is making sure that my voice is heard and every juvenile that's still incarcerated that's being charged as adult across the state of Florida. So we're going to make sure that we're going to vote and we're going to show up at the polls every time. So if you vote, continue to vote and continue to vote. Thank you.
So right now, a video, we got that video? All right, so we're gonna show this last video. We're gonna exit the stage with it. But it's another cut that just got released today, right, by another one of our members, right? Got the video to it and all. My son Xavier was the one that actually shot this music video. We hope you enjoy it, but listen to the words, right? We talking about this, name of this song is Freedom, right? We got that. But the only way we can get that freedom is when we show up to the polls, when we show up and vote. And so all y'all that voted, when you go back to your communities, when you go back to your crib, if you find somebody that haven't voted yet, make sure you take them to the polls. Because when we show up, that's when our power show up.
Reporting live, WOKE News presents the Real Talk Report with CP Time.
Hello there and good evening. My name is CP Time. And yes, it's still 2020. As I am running out of antidepressants, depression is rising. Speaking of depression, let's talk about voter suppression. Some states are trying to use the pandemic as an excuse to make voting more difficult. Like, how are you gonna try to make people bring their absentee ballots in to get notarized in the middle of a pandemic? Like, make that make sense. Okay, getting into voter suppression, I'm gonna tell y'all ways they are suppressing voters. Number one, limiting your early voting locations. Another one is deceptive info through flyers, robocalls, and social media. I know you're tired of getting those ads when you're scrolling on your feed. Gerrymandering. You better check your district. Something could be happening that you don't even know. Overly complicated mail-in voting rules. You be reading it and it's like, I don't understand half of what they're trying to say. It's crazy. And you can learn more about this at the Voter Rights Alliance. Our next subject on the Real Talk is something that y'all might have forgot about. I'm gonna bring it back up. ICE detention centers. The USA has more than 200 detention centers. And recently it came to light that a detention center in Georgia was doing unneeded surgeries, including hysterectomies. Let's just take a second there. I said that's one of over 200 detention centers doing that, talking about malpractice in just one of these places. Let that sink in. That's all facts. Now, our final segment on the Real Talk is going to be about the wildfires. Recently, the West has been totally ablaze. If you live in the West and you check your weather app, I can almost guarantee a lot of the time lately, you've seen unhealthy air quality, not just for sensitive groups. With more on that, we have LaMarcus Waves. To you.
Hey there, folks. I am LaMarcus Waves, and this is your Vibe Check of the Week.
to start, flurries of text bots on voting in certain political parties has covered the Eastern Seaboard. So, for the next 2 weeks, there will be a strong high-pressure system across the nation. Make sure your ballots are signed, sealed, and delivered. Also, be on the lookout for internal heat waves festering. They seem to be forming from too much exposure to social media, Zoom meetings, ignorant people, cops, and that NBA Youngboy music. Now, if you look behind me, you can see a cold front coming in from the Midwest. I advise everyone to grab a snuggle buddy, remote, blanket, and enjoy the cider. Now remember, it is COVID season, so limit those cuddlers to one per person. On to the fires in the West. They're still burning. Now, as we look forward to the unforeseen vibes in the atmosphere, a reminder that our climate does not change until we do so ourselves. I'm LaMarcus Waves, and that is your vibe check for the week. CP, back to you.
Thank you, LaMarcus, for the impeccable vibe check. Oh, 1 second. Yes, this just in, we have breaking news from the Cancel Council. I'm transferring to Sean John now.
Good looking, CP. You're. Good evening, y'all. My name is Sean John. I am here to give you the 2020 fall decree from the Cancel Council. This cancel season, the Council of Cancellation has decreed to cancel the following: mask breath, crusty lips, cancel. White-owned crystal shops, cancel. Strollers for pets, that ain't no bae, cancel. White girls in Air Force Ones. Thanksgiving, ain't nothing thankful nor giving about that day, cancel. Calling the cops, cancel, for now. Transphobia, come on, bro, cancel. Light mode, 2020, dark everything, you feel me? Gingivitis, cancel. Your racist uncle, cancel. And last but not least, Rent, the musical. That shit is corny, cancel. Oh. And honorable mentions, right? Watch y'all's back, because cancellation culture is coming after you next. Terry Crews, J-Lo, and to be equitable, if we mention J-Lo, we also have to say the Migos. Nothing Spanish about you, brothers. All right, that has been the Cancel Council's declaration given to you by Sean John, the very own. And now, back to CP time.
Thank you so much for tuning in to the WOKE News Report. I am CP Time, and that ain't it. Good night.
Hi, everybody. I'm Amy Brenneman, and I am so excited to talk with Emmanuel Sippy from Lexington, Kentucky. I'm thrilled to be paired with you because based on your resume, you're just my kind of person. So hi.
Hi. It's really such a pleasure to be with you. I actually spent the first few months of quarantine when all my waking hours that weren't organizing were binging Private Practice. And so this feels like a cool coming together, even though we're not out of quarantine, maybe post-election season, just full circle. So I'm a huge fan and it's super cool to be chatting with you.
How did you come to this work?
I just started organizing really for the community, not particularly because I was like, this issue is the issue, or I'm a political person, but yeah, as I came to it and have grown with it, I really feel like I've grown up with organizing and the organizations I work for. Yeah, keeping relationships at the center, I think that's what got me here, but it's also what keeps me. And so I love the work often, I think, and if we're doing it right, feels secondary to the community and the relationships that we're building that really have to stay at the center.
How would you parse out organizing versus activism versus working on a campaign? Because I feel like the way you just used organizing is so relational and in an ongoing way, right? It's not like, oh, it's going to be over when the ballots are counted. It's a deeper commitment.
Yeah, it's a way of being. I think, similarly to, you know, the Jewish world in which I grew up in, once I moved here, organizing was just another way of seeing the world, really just like the lens through which you view everything, right? So it doesn't have to be a traditional kind of protest. The last few months I've spent organizing, but really through research. And I think if we can push back on this idea that there's only one way, that's a huge opening and a really crucial thing. I think you're just speaking to, right, like art as activism, and I think that's, again, so crucial and key in propelling the change we desperately need. And so amazing to chat with you and really appreciate you supporting young folks on the ground and all the work that you've laid the foundation for. And yeah, just being willing to have this conversation.
That is super generous of you. And I feel like, I don't think I've ever said this out loud, but I'm sorry. Sorry we didn't do more. Sorry about those fucking gun laws. I really am sorry about that. And I mean that, like, as a mom, I'm like, I'm sorry you've had to.
This is Candace Dupree from the Indiana Fever. We need everyone to get out and vote because it gives you an opportunity to put your voice on how you feel our country should be run. In the state of Indiana, early voting ends November 2nd. For those of you living in Marion County, Bankers Life Fieldhouse will be used as a polling place for the general election on November 3rd.
Some beautiful, beautiful moments from some beautiful, beautiful people. The apology. That John, he is a handsome devil. Funny too. Next, we're gonna hop back into Sherry's Bring Your Own Ballot Party. After that, we'll hear from activists Bria Smith and Lisa Bonet. College sophomore Bria Smith has been on the ground in her native Milwaukee, fighting for gun violence prevention and racial justice. As a rising senior, she has joined forces with the March for Our Lives movement on the road, on their Road to Change tour. Let's take a look.
Right now, it's very much a better late than never situation, right? Oh, what is that? Is that my third guest coming in?
Hey,
Kelly Marie Tran.
Hi, what?
This is the best dinner party ever. But I was just talking to the fellas about how, you know, it's really important to get our communities to the polls this November. And truly that kind of includes our families, right? And we talk about being in the Asian community, like we're half the battle is the language barrier, really, right? The reason why, you know, older Asian folks have not voted in the past is because they don't understand what's happening. And, you know, growing up Asian personally, politics was not the dinner table topic by any means. You know what I mean? Like no one was talking about Prop 8, you know? You know, our parents didn't really pay too much attention to American politics. And my question to you, Kelly, is like, do you have, you know, any insight on how we can have these conversations, especially with our immigrant parents about politics?
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I grew up in a family where my parents weren't very active politically. We didn't talk about it. We didn't go out as a family to vote when I was able to vote. It was not something that was sort of in my realm of experience. And I will say that this is the first year that both my parents voted. and I got to help register them to vote. So that was a really wild, wonderful experience. And I wish I had better advice for how to talk to your parents about this. How I did it was when they asked me to help them register for a real ID. I was like, cool, cool, cool. There's also that section where you can register to vote. And then I just like slipped it in there.
I mean, sometimes you gotta be sneaky with your parents, right?
Yeah, what's wild is that also, as I was talking about it, like I thought I was like, looked up all the stats, I was like rehearsed, you know, I'm like ready to have this conversation with my parents, I'm ready for some pushback, I don't know what it's gonna be like. And my parents were both like, oh yeah, yeah, no, we should definitely vote. I was like, cool. So it was weird.
I mean, yeah, because truly, I was surprised at my mom's voting as well, because and also we need to give them more credit. I think also that, right? Like, you know, I'm so removed sometimes that like, oh, I forget that my mom also watches the news, knows the messed up things that are happening, and probably also has some fire inside her to make a change. But yeah, my mom voted for the first time this week, and it was emotional for me. You know, it was her first time ever voting in her, you know, we came to this country in 1994, and it's just such a dope feeling because she busted her ass to have a, you know, small business for so many years. She studied for the citizen test. Like, they've done things that like equate to the American dream. But yeah, the fact that she's actually voting for once, I mean, it's truly, you know, and I was like, oh, mom, you actually voted? And she's like, yeah, this year it's important. And I'm like, who are you?
And also, like, just what you were just saying feels like it's slipping the narrative of like, when you're voting, you are actively a part of democracy. You're actively part of this country. And I think that is a really beautiful way to sort of put a bow on what you were just saying about your mom's journey and also my parents' journey, which is the same thing. Like, my parents came over during the Vietnam War and were both boat refugees and had no idea how democracy worked. And the idea that they're now sort of active participants in it is really, I'm like gonna cry. It's really inspiring.
I have not stopped crying and drinking and crying and drinking.
Yeah.
But yeah, it just shows though, it's never too late to learn. And you know what I mean? It's like, it's never too late to teach, and it's never too late to just like change your mind and the minds of others.
My name is Bria Smith. I'm a 17-year-old rising senior from Milwaukee, Wisconsin.
I'm Matt Post, an 18-year-old from Montgomery County, Maryland.
Me and Matt's friendship is unlikely. The people in power today, the entire blood-soaked power structure, want nothing more than for us to be divided.
To silo our cause, but our unity is their greatest fear.
Because when a Jewish kid from Maryland and a Black inner city kid from Milwaukee come together and stand in solidarity,
when those kids join up with kids from Chicago, Houston, LA, St. Louis, Parkland, and Newtown to fight violence in all communities,
when young people from every race, gender, sexuality, and state defy the narrative that we have to be isolated from each other and afraid of each other,
you know that there is a new and unsettling force for change in this country.
You know that we're going to win. You know that we are going to win.
For real, watching that, I'm like, dang, you got a long road ahead of you, for real, to really just get that anger, you know, measured in some way.
Well, we all have a long road ahead of us, you know. It's not going to change just with the changing tide of politicians. And I think we need to start looking towards what the sustainable repair work and how we're going to mend what, you know, what comes after the revolution and the uprising.
Mm-hmm. I find myself like asking a lot of different systems. It doesn't matter if you're Black or white, like you're in a position that has the capacity to reform and to do things and to fuck shit up, and you aren't doing it. So I just feel like really this clip, like, or even like the movie in general, like when you're reflecting on it, you're just like, wow, like there's a lot of like anger in a lot of kids right now. And like that, we're at the age where we're impressionable to like be out here just chilling, doing what we need to, going to college, getting our education, and just having a good time. But a lot of organizers are tasked with like jeopardizing that to help their cities and their communities just be livable.
Mm-hmm. It's been a very transformative time We have to, you know, now that we understand that we've been under the knee of white supremacy, we have to decolonize our minds first and understand what that takes. And once that unraveling really starts to happen, then we can, you know, begin the real, the real bloom. We can actually, you know, perhaps start to, you know, create a culture and a society that allows us to flourish.
I know it's definitely, like, been hard for me, like, just to even say go vote to another Black person. And then, you know, how could I be saying that to, like, the protesters, the organizers in my community going out there every single day since George Floyd was dying? Milwaukee, we're celebrating more than 100 days of protesting here. And going out there, being shot by rubber bullets, being tear gassed, I'm running around with all these other young people who don't understand that, like, that they have representation in legislation, that they have a seat at the table when it comes to playing the oppressor's game, which means voting between two different parties. Even though we live in a two-party political system, there's not a lot of ideologies that are within that. But, like, it was so hard for me to go to these, like, young people and be like, just do it. You know, you have to. And they're like, well, why, questioning. And it's like, because we just have, that's just how it works. And a lot of times how it works is what gets people of color killed. How it works is what gets Black people killed. And like it's that, like you said before, that same perpetuation, this continuous cycle of like, will this ever end? Are people going to be held accountable? But what's different a lot in this revolution is that we're going through like unprecedented times, like the revolution at its peak and then also a pandemic at its peak or entering its peak. We don't know yet.
This is not the time for apathy. And, you know, from what I understand, that this election will be talked about for 100 years. It's that important. And so I understand, what's the word? The disbelief in a system that has failed us over and over again. And yet this is a call to action. And it's not the time to lay down. And we need guidance and we need to find the soul of this movement. And this is just the beginning. And so we send a message when we show up, and what they're expecting in the division, this is how they break us. And so the first thing, you know, in this, these steps towards repair is to come together with our voice and say enough.
For sure. I love that story. Yeah.
There's none of us know, you know, what the outcome will be, but we're willing to take a chance on something different.
Exactly.
It's not written into any founding document of our nation, but it's written onto our souls and hearts. Yes, we care.
Yes, we care.
It's what's driven everyone who has ever fought for their freedom.
Or for the freedom of each and every human being. Yes, we care.
Yes, we care.
Yes, we care about how we treat each other.
We care about compassion
and respect.
We care about Black lives.
We care about how we welcome immigrants and refugees.
Yes, we care.
We care about each other.
About equality for all.
We care about
an America for all.
Yes, we care.
Yes, we care.
Yes, we care.
Let's talk about that word all.
Our Declaration of Independence says we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal.
But the all in that sentence didn't include women.
It didn't include Native Americans
until 1924.
And it truly didn't include Black and brown people
until 1965.
And to this day, does it really mean all of us when we still have to fight voter suppression tactics every single election?
Our founding fathers also didn't mean poor men of any race. No, the all in that declaration meant
white, wealthy male landowners.
So in this country,
we spent the last 250 years praying, resisting,
organizing, marching, and fighting
to finally fulfill the promise of that founding document.
That equality and prosperity
and justice is for all of us.
Because we care.
Yes, we care.
Yes, we care.
We care about jobs that pay a living wage.
We care about all of our kids going to good schools.
Where they don't have to fear getting shot.
We care about quality health care that doesn't bankrupt you when you get sick.
We care about science.
And stopping this climate emergency.
We care about protecting this one
beautiful planet that we live on.
We care. Yes, we care.
Yes, we care.
We care about the frontline workers who keep us fed.
Keep our country running.
And who keep us safe.
Our veterans, our brothers and sisters in disability communities.
Black families who have had their lives torn apart by police brutality.
We care about each other,
and we care about kindness.
Yes, we care.
Yes, we care.
We care about the power of people.
Not just the wealthiest few at the top, but the power of
all people coming together for change.
So here's what we're gonna do.
Together.
We're gonna vote like our lives depend on it, because they do.
And we're gonna make sure that our families and our friends and our neighbors vote.
And we're not just going to elect them and go back to business as usual, whatever that was.
Because we know that apathy and cynicism are the fuel of tyrants.
No, we are going to stay together in the light of the truth as a movement.
To let all of our elected leaders know, yes, we care.
Yes, we care.
And we will march. We will push.
We will shout it from the mountaintop.
And we will hold our administration accountable from day one.
Because we need real change, and that means action.
Real action on climate. Yes, we care.
Real action on equity.
Yes, we care.
Real policies that give us lives of dignity and purpose.
With liberty and justice, finally, for us all.
Hey, Marcus.
Hey, Eliza. How are you doing?
I'm good. How about you?
I'm doing all right. I'm gearing up for this election. How are you feeling about it? How are you preparing?
I'm getting excited to vote, and I'm getting excited to energize and mobilize other people to vote and then make sure that their votes are protected. How about you?
We're trying to mobilize and engage and educate voters just like you.
How's it been going?
Oh man, it's been amazing. My absolute favorite thing to do is to talk to voting ambassadors. Just the excitement from folks who are voting for the first time, who are so excited about the election, who know what's going on in their neighborhoods. They're excited to talk to friends and families. I cried with a voting ambassador at some point because we were talking about voting and sharing stories, but it's been amazing. And we've reached over 120,000 voters, and we still have 2 weeks to go.
That is fantastic. I'm so happy to hear that Black Power is energizing and mobilizing first-time voters, Black voters, and reaching out to their own communities to get folks engaged. Where can you be found?
We can be found at blackpower.us. If anyone's interested, curious, wants to learn more, where to go, how to engage, come find us, come check us out. Once we get people to commit to voting, we have to have them develop a voting plan and then protect that vote. So what is happening with you all at Don't F With My Vote?
Yeah, well, as you know, I've joined with a team of techies, and we've built a really simple web-based tool that can be found at don'tfwithmyvote.org, because we want to make sure that everyone who's turning out to vote, and especially those people who are first-time voters, have their votes protected. And we want to make sure that they know that we have voters' backs, and we want them to take a selfie, take a photo of them dropping off their ballot, or lining up at the polls or with their I voted sticker, and geo-track it, and then make sure that every eligible vote is protected and recorded. So everyone get out there, vote, and then protect and record your vote.
So do y'all have a vote to a plan to vote?
Plan to vote early, basically. If the more planning you do, the more time you save. And again, you know, participate in self-determination and democracy. And it's easy to be cynical, and don't be. It's easy. That being cynical and nihilistic that's not impressive. That you're not impressing anybody by being cynical. Of course things are hard. It's easy to lose. It's harder to try to win, and it's harder to try to get things done. It's hard.
So, I want a shirt that says that. You're not impressing anyone by being cynical, Ronnie Chang. Please, thank you.
Yeah.
Want it.
And I'm saying that, and my whole act is being cynical. So it's like, I don't even know what I'm saying. I'm like, I'm like critiquing my own my whole routine here. But yeah,
What's your brand?
Government. It's funny to be cynical in comedy. It's unimpressive to be cynical with your government.
There you go. Bars. Bars. Yeah, exactly. We got to do the work. We can't just sit back and complain. Truly. What about you, Jeremy? How do you plan on voting?
I'm going to do mail. I think that's definitely something that's easier for me. And then I agree. I feel like there's plenty of time. Try not to wait till the last minute. I feel like, you know, when we're doing college admissions or stuff like that, we make sure that's, you know, first day that it opens, we send it out, it's there. I mean, I feel like we can make sure that we do. I mean, just don't wait till the last minute at the end of the day. It doesn't take that much work. It doesn't take that much time. Like Ronnie said, it's a quick process. So just get it done.
Don't leave your voting as a buzzer beater.
Right.
Hey, you got all the taglines today. I like it, Ronnie.
No, but truly, it's like for the longest time, voting was the only thing that Asians underachieved in. You know what I mean? So let's get the numbers up, honey. Because 49% in the 2016 election, that's an F. Okay? That's unacceptable. Unacceptable. What about you, Kelly? What's your plan?
I already voted. I sent mine in at the Los Feliz Library. Dropped it off in the little mailbox.
Yeah,
I don't know. I feel like what was really cool about this year especially is because a lot of my friends and I are just more aware of everything in terms of investigating every single prop and trying to figure out how they're trying to confuse us. I think something that has been really cool about voting this year particularly was that I had so many conversations about different things with friends. It was such a communal experience. And I think that's one way to sort of make it, you know, you feel like you're part of something bigger than yourself because you are. And it's hard to feel that when you're like by yourself, you know, like looking this up on the internet by yourself. But when you discuss it with your friends and you discuss it with people in your community who are also being greatly affected by these things, there's just something really special about that feeling of being an active participant and in something bigger than you.
Yeah, no, that's beautiful because we're looking at the big picture right now and all these issues, they collectively affect us and they will affect the future of our children, you know? And that's why it's so necessary for us to have these conversations, one. And two, just, yeah, don't be afraid to ask questions, you know? There's so many voter guides on all the props and the measures and, you know, information about the candidates everywhere. Like, you have no excuse to not vote. Mad love, Ronnie Chang, Jeremy Lin, and Kelly Marie Tran for being here at my BYOB party, having these necessary conversations to get our community to vote. Once again, all the resources are here, right here, votewith.us. So don't waste any time, vote early, and let's change the world, baby.
Yes, 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 please vote early. We are kind of counting on it. And speaking of resources, there are a ton of resources on the votewith.us webpage. There's a map on it, so you can see where in-person polls are being taken place, and as well as drop boxes. There's a lot of resources online. Just type in "where do I" on Google, and I promise it will definitely tell you. Sample ballots via Ballot Ready. Research your reps and races, please. There are so many different resources for you to be involved and informed in this election and other ones to come. And please remember that this election is very important, very much important, but there are many other elections coming up, and 1 in 2 years for your judicial branch and your legislative branch and other members of Congress. So I'll always be involved in those as well. Now, there's also some voter protection tips to make sure your voice is heard and your vote counts. That all of this can be found on the votewith.us website. Now, me personally, I am voting for the first time this year. I'm not proud of it per se, but that's just the way the cookie crumbles. I realized how important it is for me to get in to the conversation as well as voice my opinion. I didn't really vote in the beginning because, more, like most people, I thought like my voice didn't matter at all. But now, since I know that it does, I'm going to introduce you to the moment in which we've all been waiting for. We got a nice little sneak peek in the beginning of it. We have the performance of a lifetime. He is an artist, a rapper, an Academy Award winner, and most relevant for today, an icon activist. Let's go back to Orlando again, one last time, for Common, my guy.
Make sense of it, yeah, it's amazement. The tenor of the world and how they see you. Yeah, they already said they see us as Black Beatles, Black people. Open Hebrews, let it speak to the Savior inside. You'll see why the world needs you, cathedral. Black bodies falling in the hands and the clutches of descendants of the Dutchmen, Anglo motherfuckers that don't love us, Wranglers. It's in their jeans to cuff us. We the tribe of Levi, cut them jeans knee high. Think that it would be wise to read the book of Eli, Jah Muhammad, and see why we prominent. Life's precious, all blessings upon it. Our mother's grandmothers should be called iconic. Life's precious, all blessings upon it. They say racism, man, it don't stop. They talk sexism, yeah, it don't stop. Americanism, man, it don't stop. You gotta get that wisdom and get your Glock before they hit your block with the National Guard. Yeah, you protected by a compassionate God. We hunting for jobs, being hunted by squads. It's a small world, we want it at large. America's most neglected and arrested. That's why your vaccine, I gotta second guess it. We don't know what you shooting at Black kings and Black queens. Plus your health record ain't really that clean. We don't forget like Nat King, what happened in Tuskegee. We getting over high blood pressure and diabetes like trees. We fall in the wilderness of America. Is it you don't hear us or don't care for us? Upon a time there was a Black man. They loved him when he shot ball, they loved him when he ran. They loved him when he rapped, they loved him when he danced. But really couldn't love when he was out with his fam. Didn't love him in the hood by selling CDs. And couldn't love her when she was in the house sleep. I wondered if it's love, if it's really love at all. Cause in that type of love we fall. Orlando, Central Florida, let me see your fists up in the air, if we here for unity, for love and peace, come on.
Peace? darkness like Marcus. Garvey, I'm an artist, respect to the goddess. Some say I'm too modest because I'm the hardest. On this path to progress, there's been carnage. Regardless, this is a harvest for the world to harness. Elders' dreams, creators' promise. Being free is like paying homage. I've been on that peace, black Dalai Lama. My college was between Sony and college. The knowledge I got it because niggas was about it. Knew I had to pull it, the bullet or the ballot. It's like the parable of the story of the talents. All my people took your paper with no margin. Turn the ghettos to gardens. Like my family through stages of life. The world's my family. I MC from a point of empty of peace. Some find it, yo, through the paper rallying. And some find they peace through praise and shouting. And some find they peace through pulling the shades like Malcolm. I found my peace, making these albums. Peace. Let me see your fist up, Orlando.
Tell me if you're down with the struggle.
Yeah. How we feeling, y'all? How we feeling, Orlando? I'm so grateful that y'all voting. I'm so grateful that y'all voting, man. That means y'all standing up for the whole community. We standing up for everybody. That means we standing up for our people. Where my people from Orlando at right now? People from Central Florida kissing me wherever you from. I love y'all, and I'ma always stand for my people. I'ma fight for my people, I live for my people. Yeah. We come from the descendants of African people. And we love our people. Yeah. Come on. Unsung hero, riding in the Rico, trying to stay legal. My daughter found Nemo, I found a new primo. Well, you know how we do it for the people. Struggle of the brothers and the folks, lovers of the dope. Experiment to discover hope, scuffle for notes. The rougher I wrote, times was harder. Went from rock and starter, the voice of a martyr. White folk focus on dolls and yoga. My people on the low end trying to ball and get over. Lyrics are like liquor for the fallen soldier. The bounce to the ounce, it's all our culture. Every day we hustling, trying to get them customers. Law, we ain't trusting them. Thick bras, we lusting them. Sick and tired of punching in. I look on the bus at them when I see them struggling. I think about my people. Let my people vote. For unsung hero, riding in the Rego, trying to stay legal. Amoye found Nemo, I found the new primo. Reem, you know how we do it for the people. People said that I was sharp on TV at the Grammys. They tried to India I re me. Got backstage, bumped into Stevie. He said, no matter what, the people gon' see me. Can't
leave rap alone. The streets need me. Hunger in their eyes. What seem to feed me? Inside peace mixed with beef seem to breed me. Nobody believes. I believe me. Now I'm on the rise. Doing business with my guys. Visions realized. Music affecting lives. A gift from the skies to be recognized. I'm keeping my eyes. Yo, my eyes. Yo, my eyes. On my people. When we take care of our peoples, then we all can eat. You know, and if the thing is, if one person eating and everybody else ain't, or if 10 people eating and everybody else ain't, then we ain't eating. Because I am you, and you are me. That's the great poem that Muhammad Ali said. I am we. It's you and I. It's us together, and we all got to feed each other. This vote is not just like something we saying like, hey, y'all, just go vote. This is us taking care of ourselves, taking care of our families, making sure that our families have jobs and opportunities, and they in safe communities. I didn't even mean that to rhyme, but it just did. You know what I'm saying? But let's do it, man. We all got to eat, right?
Yes, 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 we all gotta eat. We all come from the street and we all need a vote, please. Now, I would just wanna say, you know, thank you, Common, for every powerful message and every bar and every verb spit, because we all needed to hear it. So next, in conjunction with our show, we have David Hogg and Chelsea Handler. They're talking about voting for policies today that won't get you killed tomorrow. Got to hear about that.
He said that I talk about winning. Yep. Like, I say in my sleep, like, we're going to win. And honestly, I'm not surprised.
We've turned out, we've marched, and we've fought harder than we've ever fought before for a morally just America that cares about us.
Are you voting by any chance?
Kind of, yeah.
You can go to vote today.
We have a bus outside taking people to early vote.
But are we going to vote for that America?
We're ramping up. We're going to as many districts as we can. I was home for a day, washed my clothes, turned in my absentee ballot.
I voted. Woo! This is a momentous time in my life.
Don't wait for politics to affect you to become involved. Become involved today by voting for policies that won't get you killed tomorrow.
I never look back and think I gave too much of myself, ever.
Do you anticipate that you'll be up until the polls close, or?
Yeah, at least until Orange County in California. I always look back and think I should have given more.
How many people have we called today so far?
Over 500 in this room alone. Should I pretend to be Emma Gonzalez?
Hi, this is Emma.
Hi. We called BS.
Emma?
Emma?
Polls have closed in half the country. This is the 2018 midterm election.
What difference will the youth vote make tonight?
We fucking won.
Young voters showed up at the polls at historic rates this midterm
early
election.
Early voting jumped 188%.
We did have one of the highest youth voter turnouts in American history.
Hi, David. How are you?
You know, just adjusting as usual to the chaos that is life in 2020 and the past 4 years. It feels like 2020 is just like the cherry on top of the shit pie that has been every year since 2016.
It's really fucking hard right now to be upbeat. You wake up and you're like, today I'm going to be optimistic. It doesn't matter what fucking happens. I will be be optimistic and I'm going to empower people. And then by noon, I'm like, oh, fuck it. I just want to smoke a joint and go to bed. Yeah. You know, it's just relentless. But I think I am optimistic about the whole thing. I think overall that, you know, I hope we'll be okay and that we can, you know, start to make some real change.
Yeah, I think we will. I would say probably the biggest thing is just realizing is the belief that not a single person can make a change, that your vote can't make a change. But I think that's been the impact of March and a lot of the other predominantly youth-led social movements that we've seen across the country, is that young people are realizing people that look like them are voting, people that look like them are running for office. And I think if we saw anything in 2018, although 2018 didn't change everything, it's going to take time, we saw the election of a significantly younger and more diverse Congress, I would argue in part because young people turned out to vote. And one thing I always remind myself of is the fact that a lot of the things that work against young people, a lot of the things that work against progress in this country are not a product of one election. They're a product of many elections, and they're a product of a long chess game.
Yeah, and I love everything you're saying, and I couldn't obviously agree with you more. But to piggyback a little bit on what you said, change doesn't happen in a day or in a year, but it does happen. And you can choose to be a part of the system and part of the solution rather than saying, my vote doesn't matter, my vote doesn't count. That's not a good way to go through life at all, period, if you're that dejected. You know, and I understand many people have been made to feel that way. But the way to take your power back is to say, to fuck that. Like, no, my vote matters. My voice matters. I'm empowered because I empower myself. And I think that's the message we want to get across, because you can't sit out an election and expect change to happen and just sit there and bitch about the system. You can bitch about the system, but you better get involved in the system.
Before all of this, we were normal ass kids doing normal ass things.
This is my post-apocalyptic cooking show.
Sometimes life takes you in a different direction and you gotta go.
In just 6 minutes and 20 seconds, 17 hearts stopped beating.
18-year-old senior Sam Fuentes was shot in both legs.
I was thinking about how were we gonna get out? If he was gonna come back, was I going to die? And I saw Emma on TV, and I remember just like looking up to her and thinking, wow, I can do that.
From South Florida to the south side of Chicago, these two groups are vowing to work together on the gun issue.
That's all we ever wanted in the first place, was to be listened to.
It's always the same shit. So what if we got to change it this time?
How many of you lost someone in this?
Cameron went off script.
Can you tell me right now that you will not accept a single donation from the NRA?
And then shit went down.
A nationwide walkout inspired by Parkland, Florida.
It's one thing to talk about it. It's another thing to actually make it happen.
I think we're seeing a real movement here, not just a moment.
There are 800 events on every continent except Antarctica today.
It's my obligation to tell people what the young population care about.
Welcome to the revolution.
Young voters showed up at the polls at historic rates.
We f***ing won, but it still doesn't feel like enough.
I am here today to acknowledge and represent the African American girls whose stories don't make the front page of every national newspaper.
The only thing that will stop a bad guy with a gun is a good guy with a gun.
Become involved today by voting for policies that won't get you killed tomorrow.
They're gonna shoot through the window. If they kill me, they prove my point.
You guys are being used.
The thing is, people are dead.
I'm excited because I have not seen a movement like this since 1963, when 3,000 students led that movement. Change is on the horizon.
You know that there is a new and unsettling force for change in this country.
You know that we are going to win.
I mean, we have years and years more than these people are going to live.
And right now, the future looks like it's there. It's in front of us. And it's up to us to do whatever we want with it.
That very powerful, very relevant message was a sneak peek into Us Kids. It's an award-winning documentary that premiered at Sundance 2020. It was sparked by the plague of gun violence ravaging their schools. Us Kids chronicles the March for Our Lives. Movement over the course of several years, following Emma Gonzalez, its co-founders, survivors, and a group of teenage activists as they pull off the largest youth protest in American history and set out across the country and globally try to build an inclusive and unprecedented youth movement that addresses racial justice, a growing public health crisis, and shocking a political system into change. We invite everyone to a special sneak peek of sneak preview of the film. It's kicking off after the rally at Us Kids Film on YouTube for free for the next 24 hours. Please come in and join that. And after the trailer, you'll hear a powerful message from executive director of Future Coalition, Katie Eder. And that will be that. It's all about mobilizing together to achieve common goals for change and providing youth-led grassroots organizations all the resources they need to park change into their communities.
Hello, my name is Katie Eder. I'm 20 years old and I'm the executive director of the Future Coalition. Over the last few years, I've had the amazing opportunity to work with so many youth organizers on the front lines of the most pressing issues of our time. From climate justice to racial justice to immigration reform to gun violence prevention, young people have proven that we are not going to sit around and watch as our lives and futures are destroyed before our eyes. Now we have to bring that same energy to the ballot box. Voting is not a magic silver bullet by any means, but it is a necessary next step on our path to revolution. If all young people voted, we'd make up nearly 40% of the electorate. We have to use that power. There are so many forces at will that are suppressing our vote, that don't want us to vote. So we have to vote in rebellion. We have to take to the ballot box and then be prepared right after to flood the streets and hold our elected officials accountable.
Yeah, buddy, we did that. We really did that. Are you guys ready to vote for us or vote with us, Karin, Bree? So yep. What did you guys take away from this?
I'm saying do not tell the people to vote for me. Don't write me in. I'm not on the ballot.
Me either.
But you should vote for us. I think everybody's psyched to vote. People are showing up in record numbers. I'm seeing early voting numbers super high, young voters super high. And we visited Brooklyn to Los Angeles to Miami. And I have a feeling that Detroit team will not let the bus shut down stop them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, another thing I was seeing was a lot of people were informing us to vote all the way down the ballots, you know, not just for the president, where, you know, you can obviously feel very helpless. You don't think your vote matters when it's that high up, but your vote matters a lot more and affects a lot more when it's at the local level, like mayor, governor, and things like that. And we heard that from Evan Marlboro, Dua Lipa. We got that from Emma Gonzalez and Mark Ruffalo. And so we're leaning into all of that. We got resources to work with too on votewith.us, including the ballot ready tool that was provided by some partners. So it makes it easier to research your representatives and stuff like that. So a lot of resources there. I'm pretty happy about
right, that. Right, right, right. Yes. We saw so many communities coming together to share knowledge and inspiration. Sherry Colas.
Yes.
Bring your own ballot party. The Latinx block party. Protect the sacred, stunning ride to the polls. Black voters' right message of love and action. Just so much, just too much.
The amount of people that came together to make this crazy live stream happen, all the partners, the Vote With Us Coalition.
Right.
Just making the show, you know, showing off these polling places, showing off these voting locations, and just people making it a party. I mean, it's so good to feel connected to those people. So we're so grateful to them, all the love and energy to get people to to turn out for this election. And yes, huge thanks to All In and Us Kids for sharing their film. I mean, we got the sneak peek. We got the fresh cut of the Us Kids documentary. So we were so excited to share that.
I know, like a little dumbfounding, some of the messages that came through. I mean, just most important thing that I took from this is just love and support each other, you know? Help each other navigate the voter process, and then if we do, we can all make a change together, you know?
Hopefully we can make a change together. You know, November 3rd is very close, extremely close. I don't know, I'm not even gonna look at the calendar, honestly. And, you know, the deadline to vote is, you know, very soon. So get into it, vote early, vote in person, make your voice heard. You know, this is probably the most important election of our lifetime. Who knows what the future holds, but as of now, it's pretty, pretty important. And, you know, together we can make this moment a movement right now. So get to the polls and, you know, work for our future. And in that spirit, we're kicking it back to Orlando right after this to keep the movement moving. But that's it for us, I think. Thank you so much.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you all. Thank you all.
A change is coming. Can you feel it?
There's a time to fight, time to write, and do all the things that the devil made right. Brown man, black man, yellow man, blue. Everything I thought was true was based on a lie I learned in school. We all be from Africa. Scientists can back it up. Race is a concept created to oppress, made by the white man, so they can do this less. Take all the land and respect, colonize culture, knee on my neck. They wanna take us out, we about to get lit. You know the time is 8:46.
I know change is gonna come, let's make it work the way we can't wait on them. New changes ours to take, each one teach one, from the cradle to the grave. With blood, sweat, and tears, we have overpaid. Now it's time to collect, give me my change.
A change gonna come, a change gonna come. We ain't gonna stop, and we ain't gonna stop. Close your eyes so we can see. Close your eyes and let's get free.